Colonel Roy Campbell here. Do not turn the game console off. The mission has not failed. Because you are listening to Raw Dogs. We are part of the Greenlit Podcast Network. You have a mission. Listen up. Enjoy. Roy Campbell, out.
Brad are going to adopt me once they're married.
Oh, nice. Yeah. I think that's legal. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
We haven't really talked about it at all, but Dylan keeps saying it, so.
I keep walking around in my dipe trying to give them hints.
Dipe.
I just think, doesn't Brad have the face of the guy who's going to yell, when you live under my roof, you live by my rules. You know?
You put pants on.
Yeah. Dylan wouldn't put pants on for one day and he'd just walk out. Like, I don't really care.
It's like, wow, it's jeans. Great.
Cool. Brad, I have a real serious question. Is that Turbo Man?
That is Turbo Man next to a Jar Jar Binks Pizza Hut cup.
Oh, shit, Turbo Man?
And welcome, everybody, to another episode of Raw Dogs. Here we are, sitting at number 38, and what a great previous 37 episodes. But I think we are here to finally peak. We're going to peak this episode.
Oh, yeah. Let's
do
it.
Oh, God. We're going to edge.
I think we're going to jump the shark. That's what happened. Yeah.
It is going to get edgy, this episode. I am, of course, Brad, and sitting across from me is my lovable co-host.
It's me, Dylan. I'm not going to go through all my nicknames tonight because I honestly should have written them down.
Oh, I came for one reason.
The Quinine Cowboy, the Juniper Jester.
Here we go.
What were the other ones? There's Big Tax.
I was going to say Big Tax. I'm walking out.
You're the only one keeping track of these things.
Honestly, the truth.
As a member of your Patreon, I know that's not true. I write it down all the time.
Well, okay. And then to my right, we have...
Oh, I'm Matthew Grenier, host of the beloved podcast Better in 3D, which I've done with you guys multiple times. You're like extended family.
We've been on there multiple times, but sadly, you've never been a raw dog yet, and we're so happy to have you finally getting raw with us.
Yeah, I've done the dog cast, which feels kind of like sanitized. It's like...
It's like Tom... Who, like, you can tell that he's very clean and neat and orderly, and here it doesn't really matter.
Yeah, the dog cast is like a firm handshake and a nice warm hug.
And we're a slap on the ass on the way out of the shower.
Oh, this is a real, like this. Oh, I didn't mean to slip a finger in there, but are you okay with it? You know?
when I'm like half the people, good luck editing me away. Tom.
The first episode just me talking the whole time because I had to edit Dylan out.
Might as well have been.
And of course, Matt is also a co-host on Horrorgasmo, which is another excellent show.
Horrorgasmo, the Chris Guest, which you were on. Did you have a good time?
I had a wonderful time.
Well, because we talked about your amazing movie that you got to be part of.
Pass on that topic. And we have more podcast royalty in the house tonight.
Hello, I wouldn't say royalty, more like jester, really, probably. Yeah,
I like that.
Yeah. You're in the court, though, so it counts.
Yeah, I'm there. Just, you don't see me that much.
Make them laugh. What's your name?
I do. Hey, my name is Benjamin Canix. I'm on two different podcasts. One came here for episode 9, apparently, with my one podcast, Not Exactly Radio, where my co-host and I talked about video game music, and that was awesome. And now I'm here for representing my other podcast called Where Have You Been, which is about me not seeing movies. And hey, what's up? I just saw the first Mortal Kombat today, 1 hour before I got here.
You are indeed the impetus to get this episode together because the new Mortal Kombat was coming out. Yes. And I was like, hey, we should have Ben on. Haven't had Ben in a while. Mm. And then it's like, oh, you've never seen the Mortal Kombat movies. And then our very special fifth guest.
Dat Dabbing Bitch.
The love of my life, everybody.
Oh, there we go.
We're talking about Mortal Kombat 1995 and then Mortal Kombat Annihilation. We originally were going to talk about the first two and then take a break and watch the new Mortal Kombat movie, but I found out after requesting work off and all of the shenanigans that it got delayed. So
Brad has to go to Disney World, guys. It's important. More important than this podcast.
He's going to see if we'll make a movie about Space Mountain starring him and Nicolas Cage, and he's going to make it happen.
I mean, honestly, I just
fuck you if you have an adventure without me.
And we'll talk about Mortal Kombat Annihilation after the break, because we're going to watch it over the break, because, yes.
Hey, what's up? I haven't seen it. That's why I'm here, man.
So, Before we talk about these movies, Ben, what's your history with Mortal Kombat? Do you play the games?
I played the games, yeah. That was always a lot of fun. I loved the blood and guts and everything. That was really cool. I sucked at, you know, finishing them, but that sounded really crazy. But but
you disappoint me.
I know, that's pretty much it. I would just like
again. End up, I swear it never happens.
Never. I just not this time, maybe. It's okay. No, I just do like this awesome like up down and like here we go, we're gonna do it, and then I punch him in the face and then that's it.
The wet fart of a bad fatality attempt. Yeah.
That's me. Yeah. That's my history
of it, really. Mostly like the original games?
Yeah. From like Sega. All them all the way back then.
So you're familiar with some of the names of the characters, probably.
Yes. Absolutely. Sorry to interrupt. I will say I did play the one where it's like Mortal Kombat versus DC, and since my favorite character of all time is like the Joker, I tried to play as the Joker, but then I realized his character sucked ass in those games. And
what, his bang gun didn't do
those? No, that was so awesome. It was just everything was weak and everyone would kick my ass.
Yeah, well, yeah. They should have had the Jared Leto version. Oh, you would have had like a knuckle buster sign.
Damage. Damage, baby.
Hot take. Love that scene, the shutter so cut. Bad. Love it. God. Love it. Love that scene.
Matt, what's your experience with Mortal Kombat?
So I, like, perfect for like the height of Mortal Kombat, like fanatics, how old I am. I mean, you're roughly my age. We're pretty old. I started playing Mortal Kombat, Mortal Kombat 2.
What? How old do you think Brad is?
47, 49. Like, is that beard?
I ain't Tom.
Yeah. No. Okay, for record, I promised to make an old joke to you guys to Tom last week. That's why it happened. That's what's going on. Okay.
Tom, you're closer to Tom than you are to us.
Either way, I was left in middle school when they came out, and I started Mortal Kombat 2 on the Sega Genesis, and then the Mortal Kombat 3, and then I went back and got one for the Super Nintendo, I believe.
Yeah.
So, like, I had both systems, but 1, 2, and 3, every combination, like, mastered every guy, just whatever you can do. I mean, you have a little brother who just smashes buttons. It's frustrating. It's like, you got to play it right. You got to learn the combos. Did that, and then I played some version. Was there a 10 a little while ago? Like, or something?
There was
X, which is
X,
10.
Yes.
Yep.
I played that.
And then they had Mortal Kombat XL, which is, that's pretty funny.
It's an expansion.
I feel like I played a Mortal Kombat where I was RoboCop at some time. Was that a drunken thing happened to me?
No, that's true. That happened.
Like, I remember playing at someone's house, and like, am I RoboCop right now? Like,
no. You can be Leatherface in those games now.
That was my favorite one to use, because I'm an Ed Gein fan, folks. That was
cool. How many times has he said this on your podcast?
I want there to be like missing paperwork that shows that he's Ed Gein's grandson or something.
Oh my god.
I could
Ed
see
Ed Gein
it.
Never fucked, let's be clear. Unless it was a corpse.
Oh god.
Hey. Do you have zombie? Like, what's happening?
No.
You gotta do the Zack Snyder Day of the Dead noise.
So Carly, did you ever play the games?
Yeah, I believe it was at Hamburger Mary's.
Oh.
I think maybe.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
There was one, yeah.
I was going to say. And at the same time, there was also a condom underneath one of the games, too. I was like, ooh.
And everyone's like, used? Matt.
I mean, let's be honest. There's a good chance it could have been me. We were there all the time, and I did fuck my bathroom twice. So,
you would tell me about it afterwards. It's gross.
Right? Well, you'd be like, what took you so long? I was in the bathroom. What took you so long in the bathroom? Like, I was fucking. What do you want?
Finish him.
First of all, why are you not texting me lines when I'm hooking with dudes in the bathroom? That's what I got to know.
It's a lot of pressure.
Friendship. It didn't happen.
I got a friendship.
We're better as friends.
We're better as friends.
Jesus. I'm sorry. I never do this. What?
Okay. Well, and then, of course, Dylan and I have done a two-part series on the history of the games. I've always been...
Which we did very late at night.
It was good. Those are great episodes. And I'm very hopeful Shu Hao makes it into the new movie, but let's talk about Mortal Kombat 1995. Mm. So before we get into anything else, you watched it for the first time today, Ben.
Hell yeah.
Initial thoughts.
It was badass. That's really, I mean, like, I don't know. It's that kind of action movie from the mid 90s. It's awesome. I don't know. It's just, it gets you the entertainment that you need with some ridiculous bits and Johnny Cage being Johnny Cage and, it's great.
Is there anything that like really stood out to you? Because for a lot of people, this is the first example of the paint by the numbers video game adaptation where they're just really trying to fill space with as many references as they possibly can, even if it doesn't make sense to the story.
I think that they're better with this movie, but when we get to the next one is when they get terrible. But
okay, come on.
We can't spoil Annihilation because Ben hasn't seen it yet.
Hey, sorry. Yeah.
I don't know, I was overall kind of impressed with the writing for the 1995 one.
And you saw the writers. There's three script writers of this movie. Two of them are the actual creators of the game, Ed Boon and the other guy.
John Tobias.
And then the actual only real screenwriter on there, his only credits were the Equalizer TV show, like Manhunter, and did one other movie, which is the fantabulous Freddie Prinze Jr.'s Wing Commander movie. So the guy's writing credits are real good. So like, it wasn't they were working with like a real powerhouse of like drama writing here. It was just like, hey, fight A goes to fight B goes to fight C, make it work.
I think some of the biggest strengths, there's some really good casting for some of the roles, some of them. Lyndon Ashby as Johnny Cage, I think, is amazing.
He's wonderful.
He's funny. He's charismatic. And Liu Kang with Robin Hsu is dynamite as well.
Yeah.
Well, and also, like, they originally wanted, you know, Van Damme, who turned down to do Street Fighter, which we all agree is a superior movie. There's some really good, I mean, casting-wise, you're not like the Richard Wilson, who plays Sonya Blade.
Terrible.
Was originally supposed to be Cameron Diaz, who was Cameron Diaz practicing filming and broke her wrist and had to bow out.
I honestly.
And then she jumped in.
Now, hold on. I honestly, like, I think she's cute as a button.
That's, I mean, Veronica Vaughn is a piece of ace.
I was going to say, all I could think of was Billy Madison the whole time.
You know, it's me and a friend of her, my God,
she's got upturned lip and like the little chipmunk teeth. And I'm like,
her and Johnny Cage got it on.
But I was literally just like, even when she's angry, I'm like, that's still kind of cute.
Yeah, like, but you can also tell, like, oh, she was taught that day how to do a move.
On set, she refused to have any stunt doubles. She dislocated her own shoulder on that beach scene. They popped it back in, and she continued filming that day. Say what you want, how bad her acting was. But I'll give her credit for being a badass.
Well, there's a moment where she's just, and like, running. I was like, oh,
illustrious
no.
career because of it.
Yep. She married Pete Sampras. She can just sit around and collect their millions. I mean, what? The guy honestly, who won 31 majors or what the hell the guy did?
She wanted to marry a 5-year-old.
Was that before or after Billy Madison?
She was going to be offered the role, but she wound up, like, I don't know if she was offered it and turned it down, but she did Billy Madison. And then they offered her the role as soon as that was done because Cameron Diaz got hurt.
Yeah, so she had the role, like, tentatively, and then they saw the dailies for The Mask. Like, oh, no, we need Cameron Diaz instead. So they took the role away because nothing was signed. And then after she got hurt, they offered it back to her.
Okay. Yeah, one of my favorite things in movies is the almost cast, the people that, like, were almost there. Cameron Diaz as Sonya Blade's a fun one. There's also the fact that Raiden was offered – Sean Connery was offered Raiden.
Ooh.
Think how different the world would be if you'd accepted that.
Come here, mortals. We have to go fight in Mortal Kombat.
It would have been better.
No, I love...
The Highlander. They got the right Highlander this, but not the wrong Highlander. They got the correct Highlander.
There was a thing Van about... Bear? There was a thing about... every time I saw Raiden, I thought it was Josh Brolin, and I'm like, that's not Josh Brolin.
He does look like
He does Josh a little Brolin. Bit like Josh Brolin. And then also, I didn't... like. Every time his weird awkward laugh, I didn't know if he was a bad guy or a good guy. I'm like, I think he's supposed to be a good guy, but then he's just like, I'm like,
it's up to you.
Sorry,
he says sorry.
About that. Connery should imagine if Connery were taking that role, and then he also turned down Morpheus and Gandalf. Imagine if he was in all three of those roles.
God, he said when offered the role, he would rather golf. Which I'm like, hey, I mean.
Yeah,
you're Indiana Jones' dad. You've done your time. You're James Bond. You don't have to do anything else.
Do whatever the F you want.
Right.
And when you want to do Finding Forrester, I'll look the other way when it's a copy of Good Will Hunting. We don't care. We'll look the other way.
But
I like to slap a woman in the face when she disrespects me.
God. Well, don't you respect Connery?
That's what he said.
Finish her. But I think Christopher Lambert, he has a fun performance, and I think he brings some stuff to the role that probably shouldn't be there, but it's fun.
It's
but
all awkwardly cut, though. Like, I feel like he had it. I feel like he had a character choice, and they completely cut around it because it feels like disjointed. There were like reactions he makes where he's kind of like, "Huh." Like, I wish you could see my face, like almost near expressionless in the eyebrows, but it's just like, I'm kind of smiling. Like, it's almost disturbing. That's why you might have thought that he might have been a villain.
See, that's
it's like there's an unrealness to the entire thing. Also, Raiden is a Japanese god.
Oh no.
Yeah.
So in Shinto.
Ooh. I mean, Christopher Lambert knows no race. He's sorry.
He was given the role. They only had enough money since he was one of the bigger names to like film in like in LA with him. And they were just going to try and figure out how to film around the Thailand stuff. And he said, no, that's stupid. I think it'd be better if I go. I'll pay for my ticket to Thailand. And he also paid for the rap party. He went on his own dime because he just wanted to help out. And I think it's great because Paul W.S. Anderson has like said, I was very nervous. It was like my second feature film, first with a big budget. And then you have Chris Lambert just super chill the whole time there.
Well, dude, which he helps was high out. As fuck.
It's Thailand. I mean,
no, in Thailand, I believe that a lot of drugs are extremely illegal.
Well,
so
also, those islands were like not inhabited. They were so hard to get there. You had to take boats to them. There's like no infrastructure there. It costs a ton of money.
Oh, you mean they took the rickety old like ghost ship there?
Exactly. Well, actually, you don't realize that was the original Black Pearl. Like, you know, that's how I got there.
Yeah. They actually took the actual ship there.
Listen, guys, the budget is low. Okay.
So. I mean, and also weird, funny things with this movie because it's so strange is the Steven Spielberg lookalike in there was supposed to be Steven Spielberg.
He was a huge fan
of the thing. He was supposed to be there for a cameo. In the last second, they were like, "Well, you can't make it, so let's get the guy who looks like Steven Spielberg."
He was busy developing the third Fievel movie.
First of all,
and it never happened.
I was dreaming of Rin Tin Tin.
Oh God!
But not a bad movie,
isn't it?
It's fine.
Okay.
Don't you just mean Tintin?
Or whatever.
Oh, no, it is Tintin.
Tintin's a dog.
Yeah, you're right. I was thinking Tintin. We both were. That's the.
See, that's why when you said that, I was like, isn't that a dog?
These comic book nerds, I don't know.
Tintin is a dog. Tintin is the movie.
Or they were both.
Fievel goes west. Yeah, we mentioned Robin Shu as Liu Kang. Another just fucking banger of a role. Shang Tsung by Cary Hiroyuki Tagawa.
Who they brought back for the recent expansion of the new Mortal Kombat game.
That's the only
so good.
He was the only actor they offered the role to. They were like, Adam, like, we need to have this actor be him. Like,
he's the perfect villain.
Yeah.
He's so good.
Your soul is mine. Mm-hmm. I mean, come on.
Your brother's soul is mine. His soul is mine. I'm a dude, he's a dude, she's a dude.
That's what I think I liked about it a lot, too, is, like, everything was, like, super embellished, especially that character when he's just,
oh, you think you're Steven embellished.
I can't wait. Boy. I really can't wait.
Yeah, this is going to be great.
I mean, they are hitting a lot of the lines that you expect characters to say. I mean, Scorpion only speaks in get over here's, get down here's.
Come over. Come here.
Come here. Like I imagine Scorpion at a bar trying to hit on the chick, like, get over here.
It's very funny to me in that movie when Johnny Cage is literally like pulled into hell to face Scorpion, and he just kind of looks around and he's like what I don't know. Okay. Well,
and who does the voice of Scorpion?
Ed Boon. That wasn't so they originally shot the movie without the fight scene in hell and also Liu Kang versus Reptile, but test audiences were like, it's good, but there's just not enough action. So that was originally going to be like when he does that jump kick at Scorpion was going to be the end of the fight. They just did a morph and took it to hell to like add an extra fight scene,
which actually kind of works.
But after you kill Scorpion, like, where do you go? Like, is there just like a door you go to or something?
I'm pretty sure there's an Uber that picks you up and takes you back. I mean, that's how it works.
It's like, where else am I going to go? Hell, I was just here. Like,
five stars, please.
But also, I didn't like how minimized the roles of Scorpion and Sub-Zero were. And like, I like how they come out and they're just like, they're mortal enemies, but they're under my control, so they're friends now. And I'm like, well, they're supposed to kill
That's
each other.
That's a lot of exposition.
They're actually like some of the best characters in the game, so you're really not doing them justice.
Can't really.
Palette swap ninjas.
I love palette swap ninjas. They go whole hog.
that fight scene between Sub-Zero and Liu Kang, like he was so Sub-Zero does the flips back, and they shot for 2 days to get him to the actor to do the exact same flips and could not land it.
Oh, wow.
And so when he was so frustrated, then he ran down yelling like in the movie, and they looked at it like, yeah, let's just use that. Like we can't waste our time. Yep. He's not a good enough acrobat to do these flips. So like you running and screaming is what we're gonna use. I love a movie that does shit like that.
Carly, do you have any strong feelings on any of the actors? We haven't mentioned Kano or Katana or anyone yet.
Oh, she loves Kano. She's my favorite
character in the movie.
That was the
Australian dude. Do you like Goro?
No, Goro was weird. Weird puppeteer stuff going on there.
That was weird.
I'm literally imitating it.
I know. I was like, you can't see it, and, but it looks awesome.
In the new trailer, it doesn't look any better.
No. Goro looks amen. Like, amen. The new trailer looks... Goro doesn't look good as CG. No. I will take that creepy fucking puppet.
I like the puppet.
I thought he looked great, mostly.
He looked like a puppet.
I mean, they're very creative in that you don't see Goro walking a lot, because it's just a dude wearing this giant, like, animatronic thing that's with wires everywhere.
That thing was so bad. It looked like at some point...
It looked amazing.
They were like, hey, remember the puppet that didn't work for the Dark Crystal? Can we maybe use it for this one? Like, yeah, we'll paint, it'll be fine.
I don't know. I was
Let's
very...
be clear, the Dark Crystal is very good.
No, I'm saying this is the Dark Crystal reject.
I was very impressed with Goro as a kid and to...
Really?
Today, like, I remember as a kid being thinking that was terrifying. And I don't know. Even today, I think it mostly holds up. They shoot around it pretty well. And, like, when he gets nut punched and two of his hands grab his nuts and the other ones are up in the air, that's such a funny shot to me.
The thing was, we're only, like, 3 years outside of Teenage Mutant Turtles 2 Secret of the Ooze, and where they nailed that shit, and they were like, did we take a giant step back? I mean...
There's a dude looking out a pair of nipples because he's inside of an animatronic. Like, it's a little different than a turtle costume.
Tokar and Rezar were giant animals who mutated, and that giant shredder was amazing. Come on.
I don't know. Overall, was pretty impressed with Goro. Yeah. I also like that they have just two random twin goons just screaming Goro and cheering.
So why are they cheering? He's killing everybody. Like, why are you cheering for this guy?
They remind me of that Rancor Beast handler in Return of the Jedi.
The one that gets really sad.
I imagine as soon as Goro is like, they just like go and have a beer and cry together.
When I rewatched this movie the other week, I thought to myself, imagine being those actors. Hey, Mom, I'm in a big movie. I yell Goro a bunch. Like, those two guys would be like, are extras only. Like,
He says Goro and I say like, yeah.
It's like whenever I do like anything in my life and my mom's like, very good, Dylan. Oh, you have a podcast? Very good, Dylan.
And your mom's like, what's a podcast again? I go, it's like the radio on the computer.
Like, I should listen to it sometime. And I'm like, no.
And you're paying rent?
That's the next follow-up question there. I was going to ask, like,
you don't need
is
money,
there call-ins? Dude. Can I call into the pocket? Mom, that's not how it works. Like,
is that a radio show?
My mom's a nice lady, but I'll have to ask for money if I want money.
My mother knows podcasts. She loves them. She will never download mine. She's like, oh, you're still doing that? That's a thing you're wasting your life on. Like, out of us, like passive-aggressive never listened to. I've had a TV show 11 years, had a podcast for 5 years. She's not paid attention to one of them. She's like, oh, you're still doing that thing. Movies. Grow the fuck up. You know?
Ben, you were saying?
Oh, I was just going to say, like, do you think those two extras, like, argued with each other? Just get, like, one said Goro, and then the other one accidentally said Goro, and then they got into a fight. Because, like, your line's yeah, not Goro, you son of a bitch.
I think there was a lot of energy. I think they might have been on drugs.
I would have loved to have been that part.
If you watch the extended cut, they do kiss after that. So it's, like, it really leads into it.
Oh, yeah. You're a fan of Goro, too? Hell yeah, dude.
They met on Tinder.
Twin brothers met on Tinder. Twinder.
They were the only two with the tags Goro.
I'm changing.
Likes Goro. Dislikes mean people.
We think you would like Goro lover number one, since your name is Goro lover number two.
Great. Dylan, when we go on this podcast, we're changing my Grindr profile to Goro. We're doing it to see what comes in. You know, let's see what happens.
Favorite arm? Bottom left.
Bottom left.
It's the most
so
eager.
So specific.
Because it's the like, bottom, but also yeah, it's kind of fancy. Yeah, like, the right one's how you like use the drive and write. Yeah.
It's self-esteem is the lowest.
It's not like Cal stuff. You know what I'm talking about.
You're not doing nothing.
So, Mortal Kombat.
What were we talking about?
Brandon added so much shit.
No, this is all good. I love it all. We haven't mentioned too much into the main man, Kano, Trevor Goddard.
So
I think Kano's fucking awesome and really cool. Fun in this movie.
Yeah.
And they retconned the video games because he originally was Japanese descent. And then Boone liked the actor so much. Like,
no, but
let's do it.
He's an English actor with like an odd accent. And everyone thought he was Australian, but he wasn't trying to be. But he came off as Australian.
Is he not Australian?
No, he's an English actor.
Really?
I think he has a dialect and he like lived in Australia for a while. So he's just got an odd accent. But they retconned Kano in the games to be Australian because everyone loved him so much. Like,
I mean, yeah.
Did well. You miss me? Hello, baby.
Like, it's kind of he's got like yeah. a triangle chest hair. I'm like, that guy's fucking awesome.
I mean, when you come back from work, this is how you meet. You're like, did you miss me?
Hello, Connie.
Hello, baby.
I do that sometimes, right?
And sometimes it goes more so.
Sweetheart.
Thank God you're home, bitch.
Oh, my God.
She's wearing her katana costume.
Nice work. I appreciate the cosplay today.
Now I'm wondering, for this new one, I actually didn't watch any of the previews because I wanted to kind of be surprised with
good,
it.
Good.
So I was curious, is Kano in this new one?
No, I mean he's dead.
Oh well, okay, yes, I didn't know if it was actually.
Oh yeah, that would stop that movie. Come on,
that's why I didn't know. I was like, is it gonna?
He said, "Give me a break, Sonya."
I was like, "Oh yeah, I remember that part." Yeah, I just didn't know if it was a continuation.
Well. We'll get there later, but they were going to make a third movie, and Kano was going to return, the same actor. But there was a tsunami, and everyone was like, this is a good excuse to back out. Like, everyone just, we'll leave.
I think we got to talk about the phenomenal soundtrack, which went platinum in, like, 10 days. Like, I mean...
The first EDM soundtrack, or first EDM album.
Curly is like dancing to it without the action. Yeah. Like
there's no music.
Mortal Kombat.
Dude, you want to talk about the best opening for a film ever. Someone screams Mortal Kombat, and it just goes, burr, 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 burr. It's just like fire and stuff. I was like, I'm amped as shit. I'm jacked to the tits right now.
I was 12 years old in the theater when that movie came out, and that I lost my shit. I was like, yes, this is happening. Let's do this.
I was 4, and I had just taken a hit off of the biggest reef you've ever seen in my life.
4 year old.
Yeah. And I said, that's pretty fucking cool.
Well, that
and
I mean,
then I taught, and then I threw it in someone's hair, and they lit on fire.
And well, they were,
and then you screamed Mortal Kombat,
and I went, Mortal Kombat.
Dylan,
everyone's like, what the fuck?
Little Dylan kicks a kid off the jungle get gym and screams Mortal Kombat.
Yes, Mrs. Hoffman, we talked about your son today.
Says he's Goro.
Yeah, he threw 3 kids off the slide and just yelling, "Finish him!" at all of them. It was real.
Flawless victory, he kept saying.
I had a friend who was obsessed with Ninja Turtles, and it was just one of those things where it was like a higher level thing on the jungle gym. And it was one of the ones where it was like a cylindrical thing all the way down that you could kind of play and climb on. I remember one time he was like, "Cowabunga, dude!" And he ran and he tried to jump towards the other side. He smacked the other side and he fell to the bottom and there was just like, "Oh!"
Bogus.
And I remember laughing so hard and then like, he had a concussion. He had to go to the hospital.
Oh shit!
The story was, and so he died.
That's the last time we saw him.
So I mean,
cowabunga, dude.
That soundtrack.
His tombstone.
Way to go out.
He died doing what he loved, being a turtle.
And for record, he was Donatello. Most people thought he was Michelangelo, but he was actually Donatello. Like, he had the staff of them.
Finally.
No, that soundtrack. If you lived in that era, every cheerleading, dance squad, like between that
basketball,
and the
volleyball, every high school sporting event, all of a sudden you just hear Sonya, Johnny Cage, Liu Kang. I'm like, are they just announcing Mortal Kombat characters again?
Yes.
I mean, and thank you for doing it.
It was the Mortal Kombat soundtrack and the Space Jam soundtrack,
which are two of the most hyped soundtracks of all time.
Come on in jail and welcome to the slam.
Hell yeah, dude.
I mean, that is just rage music.
I mean, for the record, it's called, there were some of the Quad City DJs, and it's the best song of all time.
Okay, did not know that. Yeah, thank you.
If you want a slam jam. I mean,
everybody get up.
They weren't known for their lyrics, maybe, but man.
No, man. Those lyrics are
pretty cool. You think Cool and the Gang knew lyrics? They knew how to groove.
I mean, that Space Jam also had R. Kelly, I want to fly on there too. So like, that's a problematic soundtrack.
Well, so did Batman and Robin had R. Kelly, but
Batman and Robin. I thought you were Batman Forever.
No, Batman Forever.
I was like, yeah.
Oh, okay. No, it is. Okay, my
Batman and Robin.
That's Seal. Yeah, my.
We're
bad.
Off
my
the fucking whatever, rails. yeah, the soundtrack is the first platinum EDM record in history. Went platinum in less than 2 weeks. They tried very hard because they're like, we want this, like, an electronic dance soundtrack. And they're like, no, it should be metal. We have a guy named Buckethead. And then, so, like, one place turned them down. They're like, we'll go somewhere else. The next person's like, okay, yeah. How about Janet Jackson? And they're like, no.
What the fuck?
And then they went elsewhere. So they had to go to, like, this smaller record company that are like, sure, we'll do it. And, yeah, The Immortals is, of course, responsible for the absolute banger. A lot of people don't realize that they also put out Mortal Kombat the album, which each character gets their own song, and most of them have lyrics. Scorpions is all about needing revenge. Johnny Cage is just like a hype song about how cool he is. But like, I'm going to cut in Sub-Zero's at some point during this episode because it is just like Sub-Zero speaking from the heart, you know?
Oh. They put out their own album.
Oh, nice. Back in like, I don't know, high school, whatever, we went to like the media exchange. And I was like, and I saw there was Mortal Kombat. I go, it's $1.99. I should just buy this. And like, it was amazing back in the day. And we got it. And we put it in the car. And goes, this is not how it's, no one's screwing Mortal Kombat. What is happening here?
Because it was a completely separate thing. And then, of course, the wonderful character of Art Lean. We have Kenneth Edwards, not from the games. And very disappointing to me that he wasn't from the games. Also disappointing was the character of Katana by Talisa Soto. I don't know if I mean, if you can't fight or can't act, what are you doing in Mortal Kombat is what I have to say.
You yell, you either are very pretty or you yell Goro. That's the two things you do in the movie.
Those guys were both.
Yeah, well,
of course. Dylan wants to talk about how much he loves Katana right now, I think. Dylan, what do you got?
Apparently I'm like a pretty lady guy.
We know. We've
Now I am. Now I'm known as that.
Yeah, well, you know every actress by name who's pretty.
Oh, well, I do. It's fine.
The first shot when they get to the island and they're in a cave and Katana is like sunbathing under an umbrella in a cave. And I was like, what are you fucking doing?
I like to think that was a production issue. It was like, well, we can't let her ride. So like, yes, there's no need for an umbrella. They're like, yeah, put an umbrella so it gets
on the paper. But the screenplay like says she has an umbrella. So we better have that in there.
And Paul W.S. Anderson's just like, yeah, it's in the script, guys.
I do have it. Okay, so Paul W.S. Anderson, for those of you who don't know, is responsible for the Resident Evil franchise. He directed, I want to say, 1, 3, 4, 5, 6?
He's responsible for Mila Jovovich.
He's the exec producer of all of them. The only two he did not direct himself are 2 and 4. He did 1, 3, 5, and 6.
Yes.
And but he wrote all of them.
He also did Event Horizon and Monster Hunter.
Monster Hunter. And I think he did one other one with I can look it up, but I mean, nothing good.
So there was a part.
Zephyr from Event Horizon. It's fucking awesome.
Well, and Robin Shu was kind of at the time just more of a traditional, like, badass martial artist, like, making real Asian cinema. Mm-hmm. And they brought him over and they had to convince him to do it. And so Paul Anderson, bless his heart, was just trying to shoot all the fight scenes in wide shots in one take and just like do them again. And Robin Shue's like, do you know what coverage is? Do you know how to like cut in and cut around? And unfortunately, I think Paul W.S. Anderson took it to heart because every Resident Evil movie, you can't get an action scene without 50 different cuts. I think he just quit shooting scenes altogether and just do a shot at a time.
Ugh. I mean, that fourth one, Afterlife, the 3D one, is the most cuts
Afterlife
I've ever seen.
Is the second one.
No, that's Apocalypse. Original Apocalypse, Extinction, I'm the movie guy.
Carly and I are just through Extinction. On Resident Evil, the same director did the Resident Evil
ones. Extinction's so bad, where she gets telekinetic powers in the desert. Oh my god, is that a bad movie?
Very good movies.
With Allie Larder, fresh off of Heroes fame.
Yes. Exactly. So, Mortal Kombat.
Yeah, there is, I think the fight scenes, some of them are pretty awesome.
Say what you want. The fight scenes are great. I enjoy it. It's fun. It's a fun movie.
Well, okay, so you're waiting for a fight scene since the movie starts, and then it's Liu Kang versus Monk, which is... I was like, who's this guy? Who's this guy? He's just nobody? He roars like a lion, maybe?
I would say he looked badass. Guy should definitely went further in the tournament.
They couldn't just find any random character. They can't put, like, smoke in there. So, like, they could put any weird character in, like, to kill real quick.
Ermac.
Oh, God. Mm. What's the...
Cybot.
That's what you're there. It is.
Yeah, Johnny Cage and Scorpion is probably one of my favorite fights of the film.
It's one of the most memorable, if only because they take you to like the absolute like hellscape, which just looks like a Dark Souls location. To be honest with you,
so the dog cast is friends with Master Daniel Pacina. He is the original actor for Johnny Cage, Scorpion. all the ninjas from the original game and the second one. And like he's legit martial arts, and you can follow his Instagram. And he does what's he has the thing Scorpion uses, like the I don't even know what you call it.
Harpoon, I guess.
It's a kunai chain.
It's a kunai chain. He actually like kicks it around and does like the proper maneuvers.
Really? Oh, nice.
In this though, they just do a little computer effect and they have a monster come out of his hand.
You see its eyes open and stuff like that, and he's just like, I'm gonna get you. You're gonna come over here.
It'd be fun to add voices to that thing.
Yeah. Hi, bitch.
Would you like
I'm gonna murder you?
I'm gonna get your ass right now. Yeah. That's what's happening.
Good Don't lord. Worry. I mean, there's a lot of good fights. There's a lot of fun stuff. Yeah.
Well, there's some not great ones. Liu Kang versus Katana.
Is that a fight scene?
Well, it's
really. It looks like the worst foreplay of all time.
Yeah.
Ooh, that's bad foreplay.
Yeah, like they're doing it wrong. It's like, oh.
It was so bad they didn't bang in two movies.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, Liu Kang's asexual, right? That's we're all agreeing. Like, he doesn't.
Liu Kang's an incel. He's a monk.
They cut the romance from this movie because they're like, yeah.
No, he's a ball cell.
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter.
The
Katana fight scene though, she's like, use the element which brings life. I'm like, what kind of riddles are you speaking in, lady? And then Raiden just strolls up to the stage and just sets a bucket of water right in the middle of the stage. And it's so fucking ham-fisted. Because then Liu Kang's like confused. And he looks over and Katana just like staring through a window at him. And there's a voiceover too, use the element which brings life. He's like, oh. Water.
I mean, it's they were trying to get the Obi-Wan use the Force loop and voiceover. Right, that's what they're trying to do.
And then they cut in the water boy saying, water's better cold, and he throws it at him.
My question for you is, because you just saw it the first time, and you play the games, obviously. Mm-hmm. Were you disappointed as I was as a teenager that the heroes didn't have any special powers? Like where is the fireballs? Where is the shadow kind of?
There was like... I was going to say, like, when Scorpio did... Or Scorpio. Scorpion did Scorpio. His thing. Scorpio. Scorpion did his thing.
No, it's... So when...
when he pulled off his face there and did his whole fire thing, that was pretty cool.
No, yeah, the villains get to have cool shit. Oh, yeah, but yeah, well, the hero or not.
Liu Kang did his little kick thing. He did the fireball.
He did the fireball at the end there, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it was kind of. It was like, ugh.
But otherwise, I agree with that.
That was my only big complaint. Where's the powers?
It's because they really played up the whole human thing.
Well, yeah, they did,
super... Like, you humans, so unpredictable. I'm like, what? I'm a good guy, I swear.
Yeah, we're real unpredictable. We're supposed to be able to fight people, and we fought them and beat them. Like, that's not... Like,
wait a second. You guys won? But I thought that fight scene with Liu Kang and Sub-Zero was really cool. And I thought the water spilled out of the bucket, so when he picked up the bucket, I'm like, what is the bucket gives life? And I didn't know that. I'm like, oh, there's still water in it. I thought it spilled everywhere.
It's a Wonder Twins thing.
Okay.
Oh, and I like that Scorpion.
Form of bucket of water.
Okay, and Scorpion doesn't just go like, he just doesn't just shoot it.
Yeah.
What his pose is, he's like doing the longest suck it sign in history.
Yeah.
He's slowing it, like slowly getting down to say suck it.
It's called Tai Chi, Brad.
Well, either way.
That's what the Road Dogg Jesse James was trying to teach us. It is suck it.
What if like Road Dogg just shot out a fire, like an ice ball or something when he did a suck it sign once?
I mean, that'd be sick. I'm fanficking DX as the bad guys from Mortal Kombat. I'm 100% in. Oh my God. Rex Fox like is the new... God, new reptile. I'm into it. Let's do it.
Yeah, I'm fine with it.
If you don't like that, we got two words for you. Mortal Kombat.
I just need to start screaming Mortal Kombat more in public very loudly.
I don't want to tell you how to do
it. Every time I see a random bar fight, just scream Mortal Kombat.
There's a part of me that wants to learn how to do a flip so that when you do that, I can just flip into an arena and go, have you seen the really fat guy
who and you
can
say, like, never do all give the flips up hope.
And shit?
So years ago,
never mind.
I am at a. Have you ever been? We're at a winter bar that has a chess bar, right? And we're playing chess. And my brother walks up and screamed, "Mortal Kombat!" Because he's about to do it. And we ride away. And the guy's
"That's not annoying."
And he goes, and the guy goes, "Thank you." And because we didn't realize he was about to do checkmate. Like it was an accidental, perfect.
Oh,
like
shit, nice.
They thought we were like paying attention. Like, no, my brother's just a jerk. He wasn't not. He was not actually doing this right. It's like I'm glad it all worked out for everyone. My brother's just a jerk, but okay.
Man, that whole yelling Mortal Kombat when someone's about to fight thing, that'd be so cool. God, I went to a baseball game for one of my friends
if someone gets beamed by a ball, just
scream, Mortal Kombat!
It's more like this, Mortal Kombat!
But I was there for like a wedding party thing or whatever, and the bride was about to get into like a little fight with her sister, who was her maid of honor. Uh-oh. And like I just yelled fight. Now that I wish I would have yelled Mortal Kombat instead.
Damn it. I think we just realized we thought of someone's first dance as a couple and they get married. Mortal Kombat.
Yeah.
Bread.
Can you imagine someone like bread? Imagine for our wedding, we go out there. It's like, and now it's time for the couple to have the dance. Mortal Kombat!
Dude, we should choreograph.
Oh my god. What we do is you have your whole wedding party like dressed up as like villains.
Dylan throws a bucket at us.
Just me and my wedding dress.
It's just I just have a pile of ice cubes in my hand and I just throw it.
Dylan, you're from the Green Bay. Did you ever go to the gambler's hockey there?
I've been there.
For the longest time, they had a thing at their minor league hockey team, and then they have a fight broke out, which happens a bunch of minor league hockey. They did the Mortal Kombat song. Nice. I was like, they really nailed that.
It's almost as if they encouraged it.
No, fighting doesn't sell tickets. What are you talking about?
The gamblers? Everyone loves the gamblers.
Yeah, the gamblers.
So there was some...
Oh, this is not a good beer.
There was some exciting animatronics and puppet work, whatever you want to call it, with Goro. There was some other cool like costume design with some things. And then there was the CG effects for Reptile, which is something...
It's about one step above Reboot, the TV show.
Yeah.
When I saw him the first time after he saw Katana, I'm like, that thing's going to fucking move. I'm like, don't, that isn't nothing. Don't joke with me right now. I know that thing's going to fucking move. And then, it
clearly isn't there.
Yeah. I'm like, I know that's not there.
Yeah. And I think that they added those in because I don't know if he was originally in those scenes because they added a reptile fight scene later. Mm-hmm. So they might have just added that reptile movement because, I mean, the special effects in this movie... Some of them are fucking awful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, Annihilation's something else, but this one...
Annihilation's a work of perfection. Like, don't worry about it. It's going to happen.
So they go to Outworld.
I prefer Annihilation.
I mean, Johnny Cage punches Goro in the nuts. He screams, and then he... I mean, and Johnny Cage, you know, he does have good lines and callbacks. He says, this is where you fall down. Yeah, like, that's great. That was cool. Those are $500 sunglasses, asshole. And I know that he was doing some ad-libbing and rewriting of the script, and the screenwriter was giving him shit for it. It's like, if that's what Lyndon Ashby was adding, you fucking thank him.
Yeah.
Because, they have good chemistry. Like, the first time Liu Kang is there, and he tries to give him, like, money to, like, Johnny gives Liu Kang money to take his things, and Liu Kang's and we're like, oh, okay, and he just throws his luggage in the water.
Well, you remember when he's being recruited, and they go to the set that he's working on? There was some, like, real pathos there. There was this idea that Johnny Cage actually wanted to be more taken more seriously, and it was a trick, obviously, but you could see the pain and like the want in his face.
And the cinematography I thought was pretty good.
Yeah.
Like there were some really cool shots, like where the doors are opening and Johnny emerges through mm-hmm. There is definitely some striking visuals. The first time you see Goro, it's like a camera pullback and you see his hand like on a fence thing. Yeah. And I'm like, that's a cool little tease.
Well, that whole scene at the banquet where eating with Kano.
And then they fucking throw the tables everywhere.
Yeah.
I'm like, why would you set up a dinner just to throw the table down?
First of all, wow. That's a prelude to every Resident Evil movie. Why would you have it just to destroy it? Oh, it looks cool. I got you.
What? Mortal Kombat happens but once in a generation.
But Mila Jovovich, right?
Yeah. But I mean, you talk about the script and how they're upset about, like, if Very Famously had one of the worst scripts of all time, when the production company, the actual head of the studio, Reddit, walked into the meeting for the writers and the producer and goes, this is the worst script I've ever read. I hate it. And threw it at him and goes, make the fucking movie. Because they were convinced, because the producer slash director was the AD on Terminator 2.
Okay.
And they were blown away by how much money they made off of merchandising. After that, like, well, we used to make a thing that boys will buy toys of. Like, and like, oh, this is it. So like, they knew going into it, they thought it was going to be just terrible. But like, everyone above Anderson thought it was like, this is going to be the biggest mistake we ever made, but we'll sell toys.
Larry Kasanoff was the one who was fighting for it.
Yeah.
Now, one of the things, Ben, you do on Where Have You Been, mm-hmm. You have like a lot of little different categories you break things down in. And one is where you just talk about like plot points that don't really make sense. Was there anything in here that just stood out like, wait, I don't know why that is a thing?
Well, I was going to bring it up too, and this might be kind of minuscule, but like when you first do see Gordo's hand,
Gordo.
Did I say Gordo?
I hope.
Fine.
No, it's Gordo now. That's what we're changing.
Well, Brett, I wasn't going to correct it.
Prince of Shogun. Yes, Gordo.
Gordo? What's his actual name again?
First time you see Goro.
Goro.
Goro. God damn.
No, it's good.
That's terrible. So the first time you see his hand, I thought he was like in a cage, and I thought it was just some wild animal, and then all of a sudden he's just having dinner with Kano, and I'm like, okay, cool, all right, whatever. I think you guys brought up a lot of things with Katana and how, like, it didn't work. That's it, really.
Yeah, well, there's just like, oh, she's the heir to Outworld, and we kind of let her do what she wants, and they don't really explain why Katana is what she is. And luckily, her character gets developed a lot in the next one.
My question about the mythos of the characters, I know like the first few didn't have a lot.
Oh, sure. We're experts now.
You've done a bunch of the video games.
We did, actually.
Yeah, we did way too much talking
about. My question is, how much did that get made after the movies and after the third video game? Like was it like
retcon? No, that was in there.
Always in there and they just ignored it? Or did it come later on?
Well, this
it's one of those implied things. Like it's like back then you could make an arcade game where characters fight each other, but obviously they're not going to fucking tell you what's going on. So all these developers, they make up shit in their own heads, and then, let's put it this way, it could have been before, and it could have been after. Nobody really actually knows.
/ cared, until like later on after the movie, people are like, why is this happening? Why?
Yeah. It's a mixture of the two. Mm. And I don't think anyone is actually being honest when they're talking about it.
Well, I assume screenwriters, in their own mind, you have to make backstories of characters. You don't write it all down because that's how you write a character. But
Sonic's mother, the owl character, everyone remembers
very, very well. That's the very well developed character, the owl, Sonic's mom.
Yeah.
That's all we know.
Well, everyone knows hedgehogs come from eggs, and have you ever seen a baby owl? No, they're all hedgehogs.
So Liu Kang and Shang Tsung fight, by all accounts, well acted, well fought, looks pretty great. There is a couple times in this movie where people say flawless victory, and it is indeed not a flawless victory.
Right.
Which pisses me off. I'm like,
yeah, you got hit.
Wait a second. Liu Kang looks down at everybody after killing Shang Tsung, says, let's go home. The ending is great because Raiden says, you humans are so unpredictable. And then the voice, the voice from Inspector Gadget, Claw.
Go,
yes, Gadget. I thought that sounded familiar. I was like, who was this guy from?
Bow to me. It's Claw. It's Frank Welker, I think is his name. Oh,
I thought you were going to say, go, Gadget, Mortal Kombat.
It's Matthew Broderick playing Matthew Broderick,
yeah. Well, let's remember the sequel, then it's French Stewart. So, I mean, either one.
Ooh, yeah, there's a deep cut.
Yeah. I had those Burger King toys. You fucking kidding me?
You
I got
did?
The full thing. Yeah. Where his arm like extends. And
I put down, you could have an entire dance party in the credits.
Sure.
Yeah, like if you just crank that really loud and you turned all the lights off, people just start dancing. There'd be no way to not.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, that's the doggies after dark.
Yeah. And did you? I mean, I never did it, but supposedly if you took a little symbols down in the credits, they gave you a special thing in Mortal Kombat 3, like in the arcade thing.
What the fuck?
Yeah, there's a cheat code in the credits of Mortal Kombat 1 with different symbols, and it gets you some.
And I think, honestly, the lasting legacy of Mortal Kombat 1995 is pretty solid. This came out after, you know what's funny? The other day I mentioned to Carly about the Mario Brothers movie, and she said they made a movie?
Hell yeah, they did.
And that was the most excited I've been about a relationship maybe ever.
You're about to be tortured.
Well, it's the fucking best. It's like Blade Runner on really bad drugs.
What if
something.
According to you guys, what if they cast me as Mario in a movie?
Well, Brad looks like Bob Hoskins from that movie. That's what looks like.
I can see it. You mentioned it, and I can see it.
Oh, fuck. He's getting the Bob Hoskins.
Okay, Tom is Bowser.
He's Dennis Hopper?
He's Dennis Hopper.
Oh, actually, I can
Tom
see
Tom is?
It.
Yeah.
Tom's too pretty for that.
All right, he's... Okay, he's...
Dennis Hopper's hot, though.
He's Princess Peach.
Yes, always.
Or Daisy. It's Daisy in this. But okay.
I'll save you, Daisy.
But Mortal Kombat came out after Mario Brothers, which was terrible. Street Fighter, which bombed.
Which was actually quite good.
This is still ranked, though. Street Fighter's amazing. Mortal Kombat's still ranked as like one of the better video game movies. And
made $122 million, and that's huge at that time.
Is that domestic?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay.
Wow.
Because domestic, that's crazy for that time.
Yeah.
But then you have to think about international when they were showing this in China. It must have made way more than that.
So let's just go around.
Also, it wasn't Joe Biden.
Pass. We're just going to go around the table and if everyone just could just give out of 10 and like a 2-sentence their review of the film. We'll start with you, Ben.
Oh gosh, why me? sure. I got it. I'm going to give it. Okay, so you know how I said that the Super Mario Brothers movie is badass? Well, that gives you a taste of why I suck at movies and watching, because I think that movie is great. So this one, I'm going to probably give it like an 8 because I was just very entertaining. Though some of it was very, very cheesy, but I think that's just all a part of it, you know, like everything, the exaggeration of everything, like I mentioned earlier, and I that was just a lot of fun, lots of fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A 4 on the Dylan scale, but but probably an 8 or so on the, I could fucking watch this scale. So 4 on the Dylan scale, 8 on a 8 out of 10 in my heart.
Okay, so that makes sense.
Yeah, I was going to say something close to that. I was going to say
6.
I was going to say it'd be 5.5 for the movie critic guy in me because it does have fun stuff. But if you're like a kid of the 90s and nostalgic, it's a fucking 10. You have such a great time with it. But
that's kind of what I was going for.
But I'm saying, like, as a person who just rates movies, it's a little bit better than average with the funness at, because like the movie itself fails, but it's fun, good music, entertaining that way. You'll never be upset you watched it. How about that?
Carly?
Yeah, I guess... As seeing the second one, this one was much better than the
spoilers.
Yeah,
are you watching the second one with us? Any spoilers.
Am I supposed to be disappointed now?
No, you're gonna be impressed. He'll be fine. I don't know where to place it on the number scale because storyline. I was confused.
No story.
Because I didn't know what
go
was
fight,
going
go
on.
Go fight, go die.
But it was beautiful. Like where they shot the movie, it was beautiful. He's like, look at the sunset.
Yeah. Carly's beautiful corner. Can you give us a specific shot that you found? Very beautiful.
Kano's chest hair.
No, and what's her name?
Sonya Blade?
Sonya Blade.
Sonya Blade and $500 sunglasses man were on the beach talking.
I'm not
with
your
the
secretary.
Sunset.
Ah, the rose.
And it was beautiful.
I'm not your trap.
And you said, ah.
And I asked Brad, I remember, I was like, where did they shoot this? Is this real? Because it's really beautiful. Like they were probably like,
is the beach real? Like they're CG the beach? Well,
I don't know.
You think that's sand in there? No.
What, we're not talking about Annihilation yet.
Why does the beach look better than the...
Sure.
It's called Thailand.
It's quite wonderful, apparently.
There's not a bunch of 7-11 cups on the beach there.
There was a lot of blacked out drunk crew pissing just off screen.
I'm not much of a movie rater.
But what
I'm not good at it.
Well, where'd you put it?
Just give like a number.
What's the thing about rating it?
A 5.5.
Okay. There's no wrong way of doing it.
We keep the stand up till you high five it. We agreed. Booyah.
And I'm not going to say like the movie critic in me and then the nostalgic in me or this person in me. I'm like.
Good for you, Brad. I'll give you a cookie.
I'm going to say.
Wow, you're so cool.
You're so brave.
No, I can't. Like, it's just straight up to me. It's fun. The soundtrack bumps. The fighting is either entertaining or hilariously bad. So it's entertaining either way.
Sure.
Yeah. And I'm going to give it a 7.5. I think the good things are so good and the bad things are hilariously bad. So that kind of works on all levels. Plus, I can just listen to people scream Mortal Kombat all the time and it's always going to make me giggle a little bit. Just like that. I saw that YouTube video of the kid singing a cappella Mortal Kombat. I was like, this is amazing.
That kid's good.
I'm going to show up later night.
I'm going to say this to my disc drive.
Well, dude, like the next time you bring a guy home, Matt, just like rip your shirt off and scream Mortal Kombat before you jump into bed. It'll work. Trust me.
Honestly, with the guys.
I mean, that or finish him is going to happen too.
Well, no. And then afterwards, say flawless.
Oh, that's always I'm doing.
Yeah, he's Bo Rai Cho. You're more of a Bo Rai Cho. That's who your character is.
He runs a brewery in Outworld. He's a cool character.
And he farts on people.
I don't like that.
It's well, but you look
if
like
if they pay extra.
Was Dylan making a fat joke and I didn't realize it because I don't know the character?
It was a fat joke.
No, I think it's I thought it was more of a drunk joke, but.
Well, whatever.
I can handle that.
We are now going to hear from some of the other amazing podcasts from the Greenlit Podcast Network. We're also going to go watch Mortal Kombat Annihilation in full.
I feel like if you're at home, pause this podcast and then try to watch Annihilation. I mean, try to experience what we're experiencing.
Right. Because we're going to come in very hot off of this. So
I assume you can find it for free on the internet because like, who would charge you money for this?
But if you're driving, don't like pull over.
It's on HBO, right?
Yeah.
It's HBO Max.
It's on HBO Max right now, Annihilation. It is till the end of the month, I believe. But all right, we're going to go watch Annihilation and then you're going to hear us minutes afterwards. So we'll be right back.
Welcome to Casual Magic, the show where we explore the fun side of Magic the Gathering. I'm your host, Shivam Putt, and each week we delve into everything from casual format to explorations of creatures and card types to interviews with designers of the game. At Casual Magic, we believe that it just isn't magic without the gathering. Come along and play!
Hello everyone, we're Superhero Stuff You Should Know, and if you think you know about superheroes and comic books, think again.
We got romance, we got action,
romance.
We got comedy, we got everything you need, man. Come on down to Superhero Stuff You Should Know for all your superhero needs.
I don't know about this romance. What part are you talking about?
We've got all kinds of sketches and then deep dives on top of that. Come on down to Superhero Stuff You Should Know.
All right, so come on down to... Why did I say come on down? To Superhero Stuff You Should Know.
Part of the Greenlit Podcast Network.
That's fine. I just may have to bring my inhaler. We'll be fine.
And
well, I would never want it. Well, that's fine.
Well,
I have no idea.
It'll be fine.
Bad.
Mortal Kombat!
That was quite the experience.
Oh my gosh. Okay. Ben, first thoughts.
What?
Like, yep.
Like, just, I guess that's really it. Just like, what? I just, you start off the movie, and it's just, you could see everybody in front of a green screen fighting. It looked kind of intense, but then it wasn't. And just people falling from the sky, but they weren't falling from the sky. They were just jumping.
Yeah.
Like, this is from the sky, we promise.
I got a real question for you.
Sure. It looked like most of the film was shot in a quarry. Oh, almost sure. All of the film was shot in a quarry, and there was like one set build where they also hung a cage.
Mm. How heartbroken are you when Johnny Cage died? Were you like...
I forgot that he died.
Yeah.
Well, no. Your first thought was, oh, that's not the same guy, and then he died, and you're like, oh, I guess I don't even care.
Well, it doesn't even matter anymore. It.
So we only have what, two actors from the previous one? We have the Katana and Liu Kang. The rest are all.
If you want to get like strangely technical, the actor that was Reptile in the first one plays Sub Zero. So there is another returning actor. But no, it's seriously just Robin Shu and Talisa Soto returning as Liu Kang and Katana. Yes, they. So the first film was such a fucking success that. They offered the sequel to Paul W.S. Anderson, and he said, I want to make Event Horizon. I'm not into doing another Mortal Kombat. And so they promoted a lot of the cast and crew from the first ones that, like, especially, like, the DP for the first film, John Leonetti, became the director of this because, like, you did so good shooting the first one, maybe you should be a director. Turns out that's not necessarily the case.
Also, he wasn't a good DP.
I thought he was a fine TP in the first
one. Some of the worst cinematography I've ever seen in a movie.
Would you think a director born of a DP would actually understand?
But maybe he was too busy, like, I don't know how actors work. I don't know how any of this other stuff works. And I think his brother was the DP, if I'm mistaken.
Okay. So the cuts of this.
He also directed Annabelle.
Wait, before we get too far.
No, go for it.
Before we get too far, you guys are saying DP a lot. And
Director of photography.
All I could think about was double penetration. That's all I had.
Well,
that's
what Ermac and Noob Saibot were trying to do.
DP.
So this Donkey was such Punch.
Dr. Pepper.
This was such a complicated movie, such a complicated script. I think Carly should explain it to us.
Carly, can you explain the plot?
Yeah, can you explain the plot to us of this movie?
Have you guys ever seen a dumpster?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Mm-hmm. A dumpster on fire.
No, yes. I've never seen that.
I've seen pictures of one.
Okay. Yeah.
So how is Sindel integral to the plot, though?
How does that work?
What are the rules to Mortal Kombat?
Why does Shadow Kong get to bust through? Can you explain to us?
No.
Why is Rain become mortal?
I literally cannot.
All right. How is animality?
How do the crazy balls go through the earth?
Animality, oh my god.
Okay.
So
we brought you on as a specialist. I heard you knew everything else.
You were mistaken.
The actress for Sonya Blade, Bridget Wilson Sampras, mm-hmm. turned down this role to be in the sequel she turned in the role for the sequel to be in I Know What You Did Last Summer. So that's where she was.
Actually wiser, technically.
Yeah, big wiser.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
With Jennifer Love Hewitt.
How can you predict, though? The first one was, like, so successful. And I mean, it's a script because that's what Christopher Lambert said. He read the script and he said,
I assume the script was fight, fight, music, two words, fight, fight, music. Like, there was actually no dialogue in this fucking movie.
Well, and they wanted Lyndon Ashby wanted to come back to play Johnny Cage. But Larry Kasnov didn't want to pay him the bigger numbers, yeah. So they just wrote his death in there. And he's like, well, I'm not showing up to be killed. And Liu Kang was the only one that they probably paid an appropriate amount to come back. Talisa Soto was like, I can't work at the Pick and Save this week.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. She's a talented actress. She could definitely work at a
club. You liked her outfit.
She was wonderful. Shut up.
She could be a part-time Kohl's worker, dude.
Oh, part-time model. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah. Like for the Sears catalog.
She works at a resale store.
Yeah.
Resale?
John Leonetti's first time directing. They gave him the fucking big sequel. This actually, you couldn't tell it, has a bigger budget than the first film.
That's not possible.
Yep.
I guess for all the fucking CG, Jesus Christ.
Well, okay. So
it was the wires.
We were like the CG really has some moments where it's so bafflingly horrible. And the story for this is they did one run through of the special effects and they just showed it to a test audience. And the test audience was like, this is really great. And then the studio said, that's okay. Stop. We don't need to put more money in. They like it. And they're like, we're going to do another. They're not finished. We're doing another run of the special effects. Like, they like it. It's fine. Just print it. So that's why they stopped finishing the special effects, because the test audiences liked it, so put it on screen.
So this is what it looks like. It's like someone went up to him, like the money guy goes, hey, we can pay for 3 really good CG special effects or 20 really bad ones. So we get more. It's like, I was like, oh yeah, we want 20 scenes.
But
yeah.
Quantity, yeah, not quality. Quantity, yeah. Yeah.
And we only got one Baraka mask, now, so listen, we have to get creative with the shooting.
I've only been in one test project, and I was 8 years old, and they had me try Trix yogurt.
Were you in a Trix commercial?
No, but they had me test Trix yogurt.
In a mall or something?
And I had to decide how good it was. And I said it was Trix-erific.
First of all, I hope that's true. Oh, but Dylan,
they didn't use it in the commercial.
Okay, so
the movie's so bad, right?
Well, I mean, I think collectively came together to realize there is one hero in the film that we actually like.
Jax. Oh, God, yeah.
He and Mataro are both American gladiators.
Oh,
yep.
They look familiar.
Especially
his nipples.
Someone saw them on
nipples.
Someone saw them in American Gladiators and said,
"If your pecs get so big that your nipples point out."
Wait, no, I know American Gladiators a lot. There's Tower. There's Gemini. There's Laser. There's Hawk. Which one is this one?
I only know that Wolf guy who's a big asshole or whatever.
Yes, Jax is surprisingly the voice of reason, just because he has never explained to what is actually happening in the film. He's like, who the fuck's Johnny? What are we doing? I was in a hamster ball. I don't know what's going on.
He just asked the same questions that we were all asking watching it.
And Sonya's like, well, Johnny never found out. And he's like, I don't know what you're talking about.
That means nothing to me. I don't know.
I like to think that the director was a genius. Hey, I'm knocking this guy's script. And I want you to use improv questions you would have as you walk through. Like, what's this ball? What is happening?
First of all,
you realize if you hire an American gladiator, he can't act, so you have to just make him respond realistically.
He was the best actor we had, too.
Well, that's because they never gave him the script.
Yeah.
Also, have you ever been in a group and all they have is fucking inside jokes, and you're just like, huh, yeah.
Uh-huh. Sonya, what's that one mean? I'm not telling you, Jack. Shut up. And it's like,
old guy I fell in love with. What the fuck are you talking about? I don't fucking know this.
Shao Kahn shows up, and he's played by Buffalo Bob from Joe Dirt.
He's also if you guys are Buffy fans, he was Luke and the judge on Buffy.
This
the
is
pilot, and then the one the angel goes bad.
I don't know. I mean, I feel like he's imposing enough. He all of his lines sound like memes and over delivered. Oh, it is glorious! Like, he doesn't ever talk like a normal fucking person. I don't think.
He's Shadow Khan. They don't talk.
He's got a daddy issue because his daddy's just there the whole time. Daddy Shinnok.
Yeah, just like me.
I love that we knew that he was daddy, the bad please. God because he had his fingernails painted. Like, oh my god, Luke. His fingernails painted black. He must be a villain.
Yeah.
Like, that's what's happening.
Well, he shows up, kills Johnny, and then all of a sudden, like, Raiden just says what your missions are. Like, we're appointing everyone missions.
All right, here we go. I know Johnny just died, but check this shit out.
He runs with his people, I guess, to a secret hidden passage in that temple.
Well, he gets thrown
into
it.
Where there's hamster balls that go through the center of the earth. Shout out to Journey to the Center of Earth, Brendan Fraser. That's what happened. But also, he knew everything to do. Like, oh, Sindel's the reason the gates are open. You got to find Nightwolf.
You know, so in, like, the Mario Brothers movie, they make a lot of extremely bizarre decisions that don't need to happen for any reason, but that's like the logic of the film. And much like in the Mortal Kombat games, there is no excuse for how they travel. They don't need to say like, oh, we travel through hamster balls through the center of the earth. This doesn't need to be established. We can just say they travel somewhere, but they're like, no, we need a whole sequence. And it's like, lean right hard. It's like, what?
Oh, yeah, why? P.S.
Yeah, P.S. So we'll fight over lava.
Like, yeah, it's like, oh, yeah, by the way, lean to the right of those, we're going to die.
And I don't know who
scary,
said,
huh?
I don't know who said, like, this is the weirdest foreplay.
I did. Yeah. It's the weirdest foreplay. Because like, they're face-to-face, rotating in a giant hamster ball.
They're, like, neck-hugging.
Oh,
it's like, Liu Kang and Cortana were about to fuck in that ball.
Oh, yeah. There was penetration.
They literally could have.
Is there, like, an option, like, do you give them the ash of the dick? Like, which way do you turn?
Which way do you?
Yeah.
And to confirm what you said earlier, there's no reason for traveling, because other than the scene with Jax in a laboratory, every scene's in the quarry. Okay. They're all the quarry the whole time. Dude, they're never not in the quarry.
And I love that Jax is in Oahu, Hawaii, which
that's where he is?
Oahu, Hawaii, like research facility, and it's just like a picture of a lab, but it's shot low, so you can't see anything, no trees, and then Jax is just attached to a table. There's no other people in the whole fucking building. What's going on here?
He's just sleeping.
And, well, I guess originally that they had an entire plot in the script where he was in a prison. He was a prisoner, and it was a whole prison break sequence for like 20, 30 minutes.
Okay. Well,
but it got like cut out, and then all of a sudden, Jax is just attached to a table by himself. No one there. Never explained.
He just has big, fake robotic arms. Now, hold on. Here's the part of all of this that really fucking sucks.
The one part? There's so many parts.
Only part.
Here is one of the many parts that really fucking sucks.
I actually found this movie entertaining.
I actually really did too.
So it is to make fun of it. Yeah. It is clearly I am in jest. But however, what I will say is that when you get to a lot of these character points, it's just like, oh, you're filling a spot. Like, if you're familiar enough with movies that you can fucking, like, just be like, oh, here's the character that does this. Here's the character that does that. Everyone's kind of fulfilling a role.
Yeah.
And then suddenly, but it's also funny because it's like, if you've played the video games, you're like, this is fucking awful.
But also, if you play the video game, though, you're like, Ermac, Rain, New Saibot, Mutaro, Shiva, I'm like, they got him. They're getting them all, dude. Like,
and
Baraka. They got Baraka.
There's three times many characters in this one than the first one.
And, for sure, yeah.
And there's even other parts in the script that were cut out where, like, Rain was going to fight Cabal and Stryker in some cities.
They mentioned
they said Stryker, yeah.
Yeah, Stryker and someone else got captured.
Yeah.
Personally, I wanted more of Mataro and Shiva. Just watching any time that Mataro moves, it's either the worst, like, computer-generated creature you've ever seen, or just, like, a guy, like, walking, pretending he's a horse.
Yeah, and pretty much.
It's very fun. It's very fun.
Well, you mean the center, half devil, half scorpion?
There's a part where Jax punched Mataro, like, in the stomach, and Matt was like, oh, we punched him in the... And you didn't know what to say because you didn't know what part of his body it was.
He punched him. It's fucking punched
him. He's a scorpion. That should be his thorax. I feel like it's going down. There's so many bizarre things. They bring back Sub-Zero and Scorpion. Well, so two jibber-jobby looking scorpion chains going out of his hand this time.
Yeah.
Also, I loved your point about the black glove.
Yeah.
That's it. Just the black glove.
No, you wore a black glove, so they didn't have to edit that stupid hand opening with the little dude coming out of there.
I really liked your point about Liu Kang's hair.
Like, he looked like every girl in Bayview.
Jesus Christ.
I said
that is so Milwaukee, though.
Goddamn. Yeah,
and also,
I'm
also
never going to be able to walk through Bayview anymore.
Also, as a person who just touched Tinder... Absolutely.
Yes. I said the most expensive
fucking hell.
The most expensive effect on this whole thing was the amount of condition they spent on Liu Kang's hair. They had to make it look just golden soft every time.
It was bouncy.
Going back to Sub-Zero. Sub-Zero versus Scorpion. Okay, these guys were both killed before.
Yeah.
Sub-Zero flies in like Superman to stop smoke from killing everybody.
And not like good Superman, like Lois and Clark, Dean Cain Superman. Like that's
the best Superman.
They have their own little fight, and then some of it's great, some of it is poorly conceived. Like Sub-Zero hanging over like the side of a thing, like pretending he's about to fall.
Yeah.
But like, Scorpion steals Katana and screams, "Suckers!"
And then he never comes back, right?
I like that you brought that up. And at the very end of the movie, you're like, whatever happened to Scorpion? Yeah.
And it was like him and Nightwolf. They're like, hey, what's up? All right, peace out.
Originally, Nightwolf and Scorpion and some other people were all going to be there at the end. But they just like,
They could afford all the bus tickets getting there.
Yeah.
We already spent
bus tickets.
We already spent
so funny, yeah. Not plane tickets, bus tickets. Like,
we already spent so much on conditioner for this film. We can't afford plane tickets.
So my question, though, is... They never explained why Scorpion is back. We knew that Sub-Zero was the brother. Scorpion just shows up from hell?
He's undead. I guess. Yeah. Just say it was Quan Chi or something.
I mean, he's not technically...
He died in hell, so he's good.
Yeah.
He died in hell, so he's like, I'm already here. I can do whatever I want.
We're back. Death has a consequence in hell or Miami. Either way, those are the two places. It's you get out for free.
Well, I agree with that.
Yeah, those are two places. It's fine.
In Miami.
So Sonya is breaking Jax out of Oahu, Hawaii research facility prison, and Cyrax shows up. And I hate so much that Jax's story arc is you don't need metal arms because you need to have faith in yourself. Cyrax shoots an acid net at him, and he catches it in the metal arm, which proves metal arms are kind of fucking cool.
Okay, also, I love the fact that they need a CG of fake skeleton. Like, they're like, could they just stop? Okay, metal CG. Like, let's just drop a...
That was the best thing. And Jax is the voice of the audience. You saw him look at it, and he goes, oh. Like, he's like, oh, that's what we got for this?
Because it was the guy was just like, ah! And then stopped, turned into a skeleton, and fell. That's it.
Then he turned into a Super Nintendo character and fell to the ground.
So Liu Kang also loses Katana immediately and then goes finds Nightwolf, who is going to teach him to be the best warrior of all time. I guess that's what it is. he says we're going to, three lessons and then doesn't do them.
Okay, so he gets attacked by Nightwolf.
Who is a wolf.
And then he turns into a human and he goes, pretty cool, huh? It's my animality.
This is an over to look, find your animality. Animality.
Animality.
Your animality.
Your animality. Yes. Nightwolf says there will be three tests. And he says the first one is courage. You'll need courage to find your animality. You have to enter a dream state. You can go the long way or the fast way. And he's like, we don't have time for the long way. So he just knocks him out.
So just one out of three.
With a hatchet to the head.
One test.
I thought you'd say that.
One test. He is woken up by Jade trying to fuck him, then trying to kill him. And she's like, you passed the test. And we're not sure if it's the first test. Or if it's a second test, but we don't know the third test.
And also, let's explain this test. He wakes up from a fever dream where there's Shadow Khan's yelling at him. It is now snowing in the desert. Mm-hmm. She walks up to him, takes off her clothes.
Yeah, in the snow.
In the snow. And then, like, breathes on his hands. Once again, doing foreplay wrong. Not as bad as the hamster balls, but not great.
If a girl breathed on my hands, so I'd...
Yeah, that's... Well,
but also, she's like, you're freezing and she's freezing. She has a fucking fur robe on and she goes to the ground. I'd be like... Yeah, I'm into it, but can we have the robe?
And I was like, it's cold.
The robe is nice.
And then all of a sudden, she turns into her weird jade costume. Oh. All the snow's gone, and she's got a spear. And it looks like the test is the fact that he dodged a spear.
And literally, it's like...
unnecessarily jumped out of the way.
One of the best action shots of the movie. I'm going to say it.
There's a couple of good action. That's the jade fight's one of the better ones.
Because the actual like spear shot, they actually showed like this really nice shot of him... curving over it, and it actually had a very dynamic...
He does not curve
over
it, he curves under it.
And much like Tom...
I must, of course, correct
that's what
on
we
my
were
own.
Joking,
because
really,
he didn't need
like,
to do
he,
it.
If he didn't jump at all, he would have missed him. So he jumps, and then it comes close, and he spins out of the
if
way.
If he had done a thing where he curved over it with his back, and he like dodged it out of instinct, I would have been like, yeah, all right.
Yeah, great. If he pulled volts over the top,
yeah,
that's volts literally, that is literally what I saw.
Well
that didn't happen.
You wish for something that didn't happen.
I know, apparently not.
And much like Tom Cruise in Eyes Wide Shut, who just has to tell everybody he's a doctor, Liu Kang's first thing he says to everyone, I won Mortal Kombat.
Like, guys, what?
It's like, we don't care. We're going to kick your ass, dude. But he's like, no, you guys don't know. I won Mortal Kombat.
And Liu Kang gets his ass kicked the whole movie. Everyone he meets. Nightwolf, Jade, your little sister walk out of the street, just gets his ass kicked.
I don't think he really wins a battle until the end, right?
And does he really...
I don't think so.
You saw that finishing move. I think Shadow Khan just sleeping.
Yeah. Well, then they turn into CG bullshit, and it's hilarious. God.
At some point, Sonya and Melina have a mud fight, because that's what women should do.
And also, that might actually be the best actual choreography.
Yeah, that could have been good.
Because there's no CG. It's just an actual fight scene.
And it feels raw. There's a shot where Sonya gets thrown. Sandra Hess, I believe, is her name.
Yeah, that's real important.
Yes. Well, she would... To me, she is Sonya Blade. Oh. She's way better than Bridget Sampras.
Once again,
in my opinion.
I disagree.
First of all, I like her in the first one.
She can fight in this one.
Can she?
Yes. You were just saying that was the best fight scene.
Oh,
you
no
saw.
One can fight this movie.
Now, hold on. I prefer the chubby chipmunk cheeks.
Well, this isn't teeth. About what you physically prefer. It's about who can fight better.
This is not what makes your dick hard. It's about
Mortal Kombat.
Thank you, Carly.
This doesn't make my dick hard. I just.
This isn't Mortal Foreplay. This is
Mortal Foreplay. I mean, Kombat.
Mortal Kombat.
Carly, if tonight you go in the bed yelling Mortal Foreplay, you win $1,000. I'll stop.
Mortal Foreplay!
Well, yeah, so Sonya Melina, like, there's a shot where she gets thrown into a rock. She just fucking smacks her back hard and rolls off. And probably was a stunt double, but it looks good. Like, that mud fight feels
yeah,
raw.
Rock, yeah.
Even if it is a little gratuitous.
Also, I gotta say, the cinematography is so. Like, what Carly said about the first one, how beautiful it was shot and looked. This movie looks so bad. The decisions to have extreme close-ups in wide shots
were really
dude,
weird.
They're so weird. Like it's like the DP didn't realize you could change the focus of the
lava. No, there's so many though that are out of focus that makes me think that they had a wider shot and it was cropped closer.
Yeah.
There are some really baffling decisions
going on here.
Oh, I'm in.
I thought you were pouring shots. Like, oh shit!
I was like,
weird.
We're doing shots. Oh my god.
No, I actually think that for the most part, there were some parts in this movie where I was like, okay, and then immediately afterwards, just going like, what the fuck?
Well, okay, so to say what you just did, okay, so there's Sonya fighting Melina, and you're like, okay, and then there's a CG monster that Jax is just punching its leg, and then it just falls into the ground.
He just like the monster dragon that's gonna kill them both. The weakness of it is a punch. One punch goes down.
And you can tell that they don't care about it because it was literally less than a 4-second shot of him punching this CGI monster. Because they knew it looked bad. They knew it.
Well, and Raiden's suggestion to Jax is like, you don't need metal arms, you just need faith. It's like, straight up, if you didn't have 4 times the muscle capacity to fucking punch a CG monster in the leg...
You wouldn't be any
No, better. You'd be dead. Metal arms are cool.
Yeah,
that's why we stand by that.
Love Cable.
Raw Dogs, since day one, we've always said metal arms are cool. And
I've always thought so.
We stand by that.
A Full Metal Alchemist.
Full Metal Arms and Full Metal Alchemist.
Yeah, there we go.
Full Metal Alchemist, Cable, who else got a metal arm? Winter Soldier, they're always great.
Winter Soldier, they're all pretty fucking cool.
I assume one of the Terminators at some point had a metal arm, it's fine.
Yeah, they're all metal.
So,
iRobot with Will Smith. The best part was that metal arm.
I made a joke. I made a joke about the Elder Gods Temple that there was more candles than a Bed Bath and Beyond. But Carly corrected me and said,
"Bath and Body Works."
Bath and Body Works.
Oh,
I heard that. It was such a like a low key like.
Aren't
this
the
idiot.
Same thing?
I
don't know.
Carly, why did you have to ruin that?
He was so proud of himself.
Dylan, behind you, I have a drawer just full of candles.
Do they smell good?
I used to work at Bath and Body Works.
Oh, really?
I was about to ask what the difference was, and I'm like,
oh so you're a connoisseur.
It's like lotions and candles. Got it.
Bed Bath & Beyond has got the Beyond section. Shit, you saw Click. That's what
I did see
Click, that's what happens.
I just wonder.
I only watch those shitty movies.
Speaking of things that don't relate to the podcast.
Come
on, Brad.
Whoa, Brad, that was harsh.
Click?
No, yes.
Click was harsh.
Yeah.
Click was a pretty harsh film.
The
movie's terrible. Terrible. Click's so bad.
I cry
for Click.
I cry every single time I see Click.
I just said, when he's reaching in the rain? Yeah, I'm like, oh no, that's so sad.
People have watched
I like
more
when
than
he
once.
Uses the remote.
I think I've watched it only once. Maybe twice.
I've watched it more than
so
once.
So Mortal Kombat Annihilation is happening.
Sorry.
Come on, Bradley.
So the... Brad, you're obviously smarter than I am. Why was the point of Katana and Sindel together was the reason that the worlds could merge and also be the reason they could split apart? I don't understand.
I mean, I'm upset about this. Because he goes to the Elder Gods Temple and he talks to the Elder Gods who are in control of the fates of the universe. And he says, so you'll stand by and watch the ruination of Earth. And they say, you are correct, but Katana is the key to closing Khan's portals. So they're either confused or have been somehow lied to. Sindel is the queen of Adenia and the rightful ruler of Outworld.
No, I know.
I know.
Normal people don't.
Even some of our listeners do, but most people don't. And
hi, my name is Carly.
Hi, my name is Matthew.
Hi, my name is Ben.
So Sindel has been resurrected. So she's kind of dead according to how the world works, but. Katana's there, and apparently their relationship this, I mean, it doesn't make sense that she is the key to closing them. If she was somehow like,
she's got portal pussy.
What the Jesus. Fuck?
Holy fucking shit.
She's got the power.
Mortal Kombat. The
deep inside her.
I mean, no. My interpretation was the fact that Katana was in the wrong realm. That was the connection that merged them.
No, that's staying in. That's staying in.
this is what never happened on the dog cast. This
and,
is not
then,
how it works.
And then for some reason, not
raw dogs.
This is not Doggies After Dark yet, guys.
Oh, shit.
Is that a real thing or is
that
a myth?
It is real. And for some reason, not Christopher Lambert. He sacrifices his immortality, gets a haircut and a new vest.
Yeah, it looks like fucking Billy
that part
Idol.
Is weird.
Oh, and the vest is fire. That's a great vest.
First of all, I mean, he looks like a child.
No, he's Billy Idol.
It's a great day for a Mortal Kombat.
That's good. I love Danzig.
What the? What, Jesus? What?
I'm joking.
That guy sounded like Danzig?
Shut up.
I'm a little offended.
Ben just walks the fuck out.
I was like, that's
it. Sets the place on fire.
You fucking call me Danzig? I'm fucking leaving.
I just
leaving.
Wanted to make a weird joke. Yeah, it's fine.
So good.
All right. So we are...
I don't even know.
Yes, you do. I'm sorry, Brad.
Y'all are good.
No, I mean, the movie's bananas. The plot's bananas. First the fights. I want to. Can we just talk about how bad the special effects are? I made the joke when we were watching it.
No,
it's a combination between the TV show Big Bad Beetleborgs and the TV show Hercules: The Legend Continues. Yep, like those are the quality of special effects.
And Carly brought up a good point during the movie too.
Always,
where like they're in a quarry which looks like every Power Rangers plot.
Yeah,
100%.
And Sindel and Shao Kahn are just Rita Repulsa and Lord Zedd.
Yeah, I was waiting for putties to drop out of the air or something.
I mean, for the record, if you just replace all the other bad guys with actual Lord Zedd and Repulsa and putties, best movie I've ever seen. I'd be all about it.
Well, and then instead of having Megazords at the end, they have your animality. Your animality.
Well, here's the thing. What's the who's Katana's mom? What's her name again?
Sindel.
Well, I mean, I was talking with her, and she was saying like,
you were
how,
talking with her.
Yeah.
Sindel?
No, sorry. With
Carly.
Carly. Goddamn. Sorry.
Don't talk to Carly. Names. She's a magician. She'll confuse you.
She's, if you talk
that's why
to
I'm
Sindel,
like, I don't remember her
my
name.
Number.
Yeah, I was talking with her, and she said that she hated doing the movie. No, I was talking with Carly, and she was talking about how she kind of looks like Rita Repulsa.
She does.
A little bit,
yeah.
Carly? And then she had like the viney hair thing going
it's
on.
It's like the lipstick that's like kind of chrome.
That,
bad.
The color.
Yeah. I mean, yes.
The colors.
Well, she looks like... Bold
oh,
colors.
I thought you said you look like Rita Repulsa.
No.
I was going to say, I have to...
Carly looks like Goldar. She's got wings. Goldar. She's got a big old sword.
Lion face.
Yeah.
Jade.
This is all makeup. She takes it off. It's
like oh my god, it's Jesus.
Whoa.
Christ.
Jade is objectified by every man in the film.
Yeah.
And every man in the theater.
Well, you made a good point. So, Raiden is mortal for 5 seconds. He's like, can she fight as good as she looks? It's like, whoa, you're thirsty really fast,
yeah,
dude.
Like, quick.
Because I have
quick.
Not been horny since, I know, like 2,000 years before Christ. I'm not ready.
Dude's had a mortal dick for 5 seconds. He's like, yo, what's up?
What's up?
Holy shit, what's going on?
And even Jax is like putting his arm around her and stuff. And she's like, it was all too easy.
So that's the thing about
you
it.
You saw my pussy and I was able to trick you.
Well, this is not portal pussy. This is persuasion pussy.
Persuasion pussy.
She rolled a nat 20 on her die and she was got that persuasion pussy.
I didn't understand her
whole
deal.
Plus 13 charisma.
It was like she was helping for a little bit and then the way she was like, I'm the bad guy, by the way. And then she like... left the room.
Dude,
like,
her eyeshadow changes.
Yeah.
Seriously, her eyeshadow gets more evil in like one shot, and it's like, I'm a villain.
By the way.
It's like a Nightman and Always Sunny. It's like,
whoa, fight.
Well, that's
seriously like that.
But the thing about Jade is like she said, I'm a bad guy, like backs out of the room slowly, then gets choked by the dude, and then dies. That's
eaten
that's
by
it.
A dragon from the wall. For like, it seems like his power is to summon weird dragons from stone all the time. Why is he not using, like, there's so much to spread. They have magic powers, like you said.
Yeah.
Also, Jax and Sony are soldiers. If they just had a pistol, they would have won this thing within the first 10 minutes. Like,
But we don't know Outworlders. I mean, Mataro can take metal punches. But he can't take a non-metal punch to his
thorax.
Wow.
And like Shadow Khan really dies by getting kicked in the face. That's how he dies. Oh, I got kicked in the chin.
Are we calling it a thorax, though?
Yeah, we're going thorax, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay. All right.
Man, you guys keep saying thorax, and I keep thinking about the Lorax from Dr. Seuss.
Yeah.
Jesus.
What is Lorax and stuff?
Danny DeVito as Mataro? One of my favorite lines in the film is from Shinnok, like when Shao Kahn's trying to say he has it under control, and he goes, "Do not underestimate the power of the human spirit." I was like, "Whoa, dude, you got some experience with the human spirit. We don't know."
The human spirit does great things. I said, "Did you not just see the Dream Team win the whole thing?"
I've seen Smash Mouth.
Have you guys ever seen the Mighty Ducks?
I mean, yeah. Quack. Quack, quack,
flying
quack.
Bee.
Have you ever seen me solve diarrhea?
Did you watch the movie The Sandlot? He's Benny the Legs. Sorry.
The beast is no match.
God. Also, we kind of got later on thing when they go full CG on full CG. It is literally just one step lower than the show Beast Wars from Fox.
It was really bad.
It was actually worse.
Yeah.
It is a step lower.
Yeah, it's a little bit. And that TV show had been on for a couple of years, and it's a TV show for children.
I love it when Sonya Blade says Sonya Blade says the iconic line, "I saw a robot and a lady with that tattoo."
Yeah, I was like, "You're saying it wrong." She goes, "I saw a dragon tattoo that flew away. I saw it on a robot and a lady." Like the robot's okay, but a lady with a tattoo, she's fighting people.
It sounds like it's just like something that was drawn on.
I know this cooler beer is so good.
That is pretty good.
Well. One of the things that stood out about this entire movie to me, it was literally just the fact that none of the action or anything actually connected. Even the CGI scenes that you saw off in the distance, I could tell they were trying to raise the stakes. You see the Eiffel Tower raised for no reason.
I wish there was just like a French dude with like baguettes running around too.
Oh no! It was my cigarettes!
Is this a Mortal Kombat?
It was a hard day for Paris.
No, I have my siesta and get my... 3 weeks holiday for Spain. Every month.
You can't even do the joke
I'll
right.
I'll fight you with my 3-week-old baguette.
There it is. That's how the joke lands.
Yes. And she didn't talk over anyone. It was great. That's how they work. No, you're good.
I try to get control of my podcast too because I get it.
Do you edit?
I do edit.
Yeah, you get it.
There's no man, no God, no law.
What's the thing? Like when I record with like Not Exactly Radio, it's all on one track, so I can't even like edit that.
I mean, I don't want to like talk forever on Annihilation, but we have to at least say that they brought the original song back for a second.
That was cool.
No, they brought the original song back for the opening, which is the most important. Like, we all sat down to start watching the movie, and then
it was lit.
I made sure it was like louder than it probably should be, and someone said Mortal Kombat. Everyone was like, "Oh, okay,
yeah."
I want to say something controversial. That was the best scene in the movie. That opening scene where they just you fire on the cymbal and just play that song. I was like, yes.
And they do bring it back. And it's only playing during the Liu Kang Shao Kahn fight for like 10 seconds. And then Shao Kahn gets the upper hand and it stops.
Yeah, I was going to say it only plays when Liu Kang.
But then Liu Kang comes back and it's like, buh, 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 buh. I was like, okay, good. It's back.
I assumed what happened was he had the song playing on his Sony Walkman CD player.
It was
and it skipped when it bounced. That's why it didn't actually stop. It didn't stop playing.
Okay, let's talk about Shao Kahn. Let's talk about this motherfucker.
Baron von Underbite.
I was going to use that joke. Damn it, you were.
Fuck. Yes, I nailed
you
it.
You got
played by Brian Thompson. Of course, that asshole with an underbite who looks like an idiot.
I really don't like doing that guy. You're doing a great job, Brad. Morning, Brad. Thank you.
I don't think he's well cast. No, I don't like him in this film.
Like his expressive eyes.
I feel like every line is so overperformed. It's just like they tried to even chew the scenery and they wind up eating the film or something.
Hot take. He's the best part of this movie. Because everyone else is sleepwalking through this movie. I guess I got to pretend like I'm punching someone to get a paycheck. He's giving his all. No one in this movie gives a fuck about their acting.
I guess he had actually an actual story. He's like, dad issues. This sucks. Oh, I got to destroy the world for dad.
Even at the end, he's like, daddy, save me.
He's like, I have to do everything.
And the other god's like, he's a cube now. He can't.
If this is a trilogy, he's the Thanos. The whole movie is about him. This is Infinity War again, where all the heroes just running around and it's
Let's be
clear,
the Eternals is going to be about Thanos.
Sure. Okay. That's a whole other podcast.
Do you mean the Elder Gods?
No.
Oh, you meant something not related?
I think he would have been a better character if he had the mask on the whole time.
He should have had the mask on the whole time. Yeah. I don't know. He couldn't have conveyed all of his beautiful acting moments, though.
Ask Tom Hardy how hard it is to do with Bane. You can't have the mask on the whole time. You got to take it off.
I guess fair.
Especially when he kills random people for no apparent reason. You're my general, and you maybe wait a minute. You're on fire. That's done. What he does.
Cool. Yeah, you failed.
They did one run on the special effects, which is very apparent at the end.
Yeah.
I like when Liu Kang goes animality, and everyone's like, oh, that's pretty bad. And then Shao Kahn's like, wait till you see this.
He's just like a hydra. Yes.
His head. Like a tapeworm.
His forehead goes like a foot high. And then just like, whoop, I'm a tapeworm.
With like six heads.
Six headed tapeworm monster.
I was immediately just like, oh yeah, that's a
fight. And the editor's like, I don't know when I'm allowed to cut away to real people because it's going to make this all look worse. So there's two cutaways to someone you're like, ugh. But otherwise, they just like, I don't know what we're doing. We just hold on the things.
And then it was over.
Yeah. And the fight was, they kind of push each other for a second and they both fell their backs and like, oh, we're done. Like, oh, it took a lot of concentration to become an animal, I guess.
Meanwhile, Scorpion just like looking at his signed photograph of Johnny Cage in hell is like, this is cool.
This is real cool. I like that.
What a sucker.
One of the few comforts I have here in hell.
I just wish I had more friends. I'm so lonely. Help me.
He stole a friend, but then he had to give her to
that guy. I just wish I had more friends.
What if I was the sucker the whole time?
I'm the sucker.
I'm the sucker.
I think Sub-Zero and I could be good friends.
Yes. There was an alternate ending shot for this film that was removed.
Shut up.
No, what?
That's it. That's sorry.
No.
Is this more Blade Survives? Oh, that's Blade Trinity.
Quan Chi was played by a Taiwanese person who spoke no English, so there's no dialogue from him in the shot, but it's Shinnok, Daddy Shinnok, talking with Quan Chi, and he says, "The plan, like, everything's going according to plan." And Quan Chi just nods because he doesn't speak English. Mm. And that would have been the ending, like Quan Chi is going to be the bad guy for Mortal Ooh. Kombat Devastation, which was never filmed. So the plan for Mortal Kombat Devastation, Christopher Lambert was going to be back as Raiden. Mm-hmm. Lyndon Ashby was going to get resurrected as Johnny Cage. So we're like, we realize we made mistakes. We're bringing some of the good people back.
Somehow we'll make it work.
It's Mortal Kombat.
It's Mortal Kombat.
It's fine. Scorpion
Jax would return. Sonya would return from Annihilation. Thank God I hated Bridget Wilson. She's got a really great chipmunk face, Dylan, I know, but she can't do any fighting.
That's all Dylan wants.
Maybe with practice.
Yeah, could have been by that
do time. Do I want Maybe. Someone who can kick my ass? Kind of. It's fine.
I think Kano was supposed to return as well. I sure hope he was. But they were trying to get this movie made for a while. And Lyndon Ashby said in some interviews, like, I read the script. It's really good. And I think that just means, like, what? Oh, I'm actually in it. I'm getting a paycheck. Probably, but I don't
Is
know.
Is there any chance might have got paid they out had a certain amount of money for the two sequels? They're like, hey, we're not going to spend any money on the second one because the third one's so amazing. We got to waste all that money on the third one. It just never happened. Because this second one was like, it was almost like a dare. Like, hey, please cancel our third one. This is so bad. The fighting was bad. Except for the Ray Park fighting Raiden scene. That was actually a good fighting scene.
You mean where there is 10 kicks that don't hit anything? They're just like air whiffing each other, not even trying to hit.
It looks like they're athletic at least. These people look like they
look like gears working together.
Yeah.
It looks like dancing. It's fight dancing.
I don't know. I think there were some good fights in this movie. There were also some really bad ones, but I thought a lot of it held up. Robin Shu did a lot of the fight choreography, so anything that's physical and with anyone who actually has done martial arts, I think looks fine. Anything that is CG or with someone who isn't someone who's done martial arts looks really bad. I don't know.
What's the name of the character who's the lady whose forearms this one? I forget her name.
Shiva.
She looks so much better than Goro, but like dies instantly? Like she just gets killed
very dumb way. Sorry.
Yeah. No, a cage falls in her because they didn't have the budget to do the fight scene they intended. They wanted a katana to fight her, but they didn't have the budget, so they're just like,
kill her.
Squash her.
Kill her
with the cage.
And you guys I don't think noticed, but when Rain gets killed by Shao Kahn and thrown into the fire, it's the exact same shot as when Baraka falls into the fire.
Oh shit.
Yeah, I actually I was like, wait. What? Okay.
Fire's expensive, guys. You gotta be
one time.
So that was Mortal Kombat and Mortal Kombat Annihilation. We are this is releasing the day before the new Mortal Kombat comes out. So
Can I ask you a question real quick?
Yeah.
You guys have seen both the movies now? Uh-huh. What is your favorite character from the movie and the favorite character from the video games? So if you're playing the video games, I will say Mortal Kombat 1 through 3, because that was roughly the time these movies came out. Who is yours?
Sadly, it's Jax right now.
For the movie?
For the previous ones?
The two movies we just saw. And then who's your favorite character from the games? Like to play. Who is your guy when you... Or lady?
Well, it's not who I'm playing for me, because Mortal Kombat is more of like an experience for me.
Okay, characters you embody?
You're so bold. Shu Hao. He is one of the worst characters ever. He's like an undead general who gets shit on by everybody. I think I was Shu Hao in the thumbnail for our Mortal Kombat episode. He's one of the worst characters ever, I'm desperately in love with the man.
He loves Shu Hao.
Ben, what do you got? Favorite character in the movie, favorite one to play with?
I think I have to go with favorite character in the movie. I have to go with Jax, because he was exactly like us when watching the movie. It was like, he's the only relatable character.
It could be either movie.
It's like, wait. I was trying to think of the first one.
He wasn't in the first movie.
I know he wasn't in the first one, but I couldn't think of anyone.
He was for a second, yeah.
Oh.
Oh, well,
different actor, but yes. they were going on that boat to like...
But in another movie, yeah. Jax is...
Oh, yeah, that's why he went with Sonya.
Jax is the only person... Like, he is the audience. Like, who the fuck's Johnny? Like, what... You just saved me from some facility. I got attacked by a robot. We rode a hamster ball through the planet. I don't know what's happening.
And then favorite character in the video game. I really like playing with Raiden. Okay. He was a lot of fun.
Yeah, Raiden's good.
Yeah.
Dilly?
I'm going to say Reptile all the way through.
And both ones?
Oh, yeah.
I respect it.
Reptile in the first one is so funny.
It shows up.
He's like this iguana guy with a big mouth. It's like something I would fucking draw. And I think he goes, nah, 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 with his mouth. And
you don't really understand, like, what Reptile is in the first movie either. Because he's this, like, cloaked dude, and then he gets knocked into, like, a statue thing, eaten by, grabbed by worms, and becomes part of a statue thing. I don't know what that is.
In the games, he can, like, spit poison and do all this stuff. I'm like, there's a real ninja dog. Like, he's got a weird, like,
he's a ninja that can spit poison in your mouth.
And he'll dissolve you with his horseshit. I fucking love it. I think he's fucking any character with a bunch of poison. I really like. So,
okay. I personally love Johnny Cage for the first one. That's my favorite character, just because.
Yeah, he was good.
Johnny Cage. It's what you wanted to be, but could never be.
No, I wanted to be Katana. That's what I was like. I want to wear tops like that. Yeah,
he is Johnny Cage. He wants to be Katana. Yeah,
and you should see him in an Alice in Wonderland.
I've seen Matt in so many caves with umbrellas. I'm like, it's not the same.
It's not the same. And then also, my favorite character play was either Cyrax or Sony Blade. I went back and forth through this, but I was terrible. Net, bring over. Let me punch you in the face once. Go back that way. So.
You were a spammer.
As long as they didn't flawless victory you, you were doing well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Charlie?
Lisa. Okay. Hear me out. Oh. Those of you who have heard me on this podcast maybe once or twice before know that I don't play video games.
How are you guys? You guys getting married?
Yeah.
Cool. Sorry.
No, we're good. I don't remember who I would play, but I played. And like pinball, I'm very good at pinball. And I was very good at Mortal Kombat on like the arcade game version of it. And I think I have to agree with Ben. I really like Jax because he was just so relatable. Like, I didn't know what the fuck was going on in the second movie. Sure. So... That's where I stand.
The only thing I disagree with Jax is that metal arms are cool. Yeah. And his character arc should have been, Raiden's wrong. Metal arms are fucking cool.
My arms are fucking rock solid.
If I had big ass robot arms, you think I'd have these fucking things?
Like, what if he like beat Mataro's head into a pulp and then flicks Raiden off with a metal finger? That would have been cool.
Even better, he saves Raiden with his metal arms. Like a sword's coming down, he comes and saves
him. And Raiden's I've never been more wrong in my life.
He's
like,
he's right.
Never
sorry.
Been.
So the new Mortal Kombat movie drops tomorrow, if you're listening to this. It's directed by Simon McQuaid. So I looked Simon McQuaid up. I didn't know who he was.
Tell us about him.
And this is his feature film debut. What he has done before is a lot of commercials. And, well, this this sounds silly, but the commercials he's made are ones that I'm familiar with.
Okay.
So he did the Halo 3 commercial where it's all the veterans, holding old weapons. He's like the old guy, like this was a...
This is like a brute spike rifle, and it's kind of hard to hold right now. I don't like touching these things anymore. And he did one, like, which is a PlayStation commercial where it's like all the biggest PlayStation characters in a bar talking about how great Mike was, and they all remember Mike.
That was great. I know that commercial. That was a great commercial. Yeah.
And, like, I don't know. I mean, the commercials he's done are very
Zack
good.
Zack Snyder is a good commercial guy.
Well, the same thing.
No, this isn't what we're talking about.
No, but like, he's not. He's
we're talking about a guy who's made like commercials that have like substance to them, and I appreciate it. You're talking about Zack Snyder.
These are different. If you're
so Spike Jonze did commercials first. Like, there's a lot of people who do commercials and they go like, Spike Jonze, Mick G. Like they can start in commercials and work their way over.
I saw that he did these commercials and I was like, he understands how to convey emotion and like a past in a character. It gives me hope. I'm hopeful for the new Mortal Kombat movie. I'm hoping that it's not going to shoehorn too many things in. I hope that
they are
stick to true martial arts.
Nope.
The action looks good in the trailer so far, and they're going for R rating, which I like. The
trailers are great.
Dylan,
fuck man.
Wait, no. Dylan, what do you really think about the new Mortal Kombat?
I actually think it looks like absolute dog shit. I think this is going to be a nightmare. I think it's going to be the same exact thing. Like, if you want like things that look cool strung together, when you talk about commercials, you're talking about a person who made something that is evocative for its own time. And those are 30-minute segments, no matter what you're doing.
Or 30-second segments. Those would have been long commercials.
But what I'm saying is, like, if you're actually trying to get something across in long-form storytelling, if you're not going to bring it into the medium and you're not going to do it correctly, you're already done to begin with.
Well, dude, you can't judge him as a commercial director.
I can assume. The reality is that assumption created.
Stanley Kubrick was obsessed with beer commercials, and he used to get them, like, filmed and sent to him because he thought film, like, TV commercials were one of the ultimate forms of filmmaking.
Yes.
Because you have to tell an entire story in 30 seconds.
Can I be real quick? The list of directors who directed commercials before they directed any feature films, this is a list. Darren Aronofsky, David Lynch, Martin Scorsese, Wes Anderson, Sofia Coppola. They all did commercials before they did.
Bunch of hacks, dude. Those are just commercial directors.
100% true.
Michael Bay. Yeah. I win.
Not what I'm saying. Okay, this movie's going to be bad. That's all I'm going to say. Well, how about I put it at that? How about I put it as a prediction? How about I make sure that this movie is going to be bad, and I'll tell you why.
How do you make sure?
A series of weird, strung-out events that have maybe some cool action scenes and then are interspliced in between a bare-bones story that no one cares about. That is the movie we just saw.
And also the film that's coming out.
No, I agree with that. I don't think this movie's going to be good. I really don't. I think the only reason the first one works because they actually made PG-13.
But that doesn't make me wrong.
No, Dylan, we agree with you. I agree with your
end result, not your reasoning, that it's all like, oh, the director does commercials. But I'm just saying, like, I agree with you. I think this is gonna be one of the things where...
Commerciality and creativity...
No, Dylan, we agree with you. Sad. You're just a dick.
Yeah, yeah. No.
Oh, golly.
No, I'm saying, like, it's fan service gone awry. It's like the last Godzilla movie that came out. Like, we want this. And when you get it, you're like, oh, I actually didn't want that. Like,
Of people like this new one.
I'm just saying that I...
Wait, no spoilers. I didn't see it yet.
I'm just saying I think the director has ability, but they're also...
Godzilla gets a big old dick, and he swings it around.
Just swings and kills.
He just kills buildings.
Zip
thud. Not humans, though.
I think this film is going to fall victim to trying to shoehorn way too many characters in because I've seen the cast list.
Yes, of course.
I think there's going to be good action. I think it's going to be R-rated action. And I think that a lot of other things are going to fail, but it'll still be successful.
It's going back! Yeah. So I want to bring this up earlier when we were talking about the first movie, because like there was a lot of pushback on Mortal Kombat 1 that it wasn't R-rated because it was super violent and that was the thing. I don't think that first movie would have been successful. They made it already because, like, they needed the campiness of it to kind of, like, go to kids, go across fans. So, like, now that we're in a hard R Mortal Kombat, which we all say we want, I feel like it might not actually work because, like, you know what? The scenes you see look great, but the same thing, though, the scenes from the Suicide Squad look great before I saw that.
Suicide Squad?
Yeah.
I don't need to see violent murders on screen for Mortal Kombat to... I don't need to see violent murders on screen for Mortal Kombat to be satisfying.
I don't either. I
need stupid characters with backstories that I know too much about that don't matter.
First of all, you know for a fact that they're going to do what they did in the video games, and they're going to show you zoom-ins where it shows like the punches hit, and then it's going to show their bones breaking in an X-ray fashion.
No, they won't.
Yes, they will.
No, they won't.
I will bet $25 on that right now, and I'm going
to. I'll bet in any topic you want. Raw dogs.
Oh, don't do. Oh, you. That's even worse.
So you're gonna say there's gonna be an X-ray shot of a bone breaking?
Yep. $25.
What is?
So I saw them shake. It's a witness.
My question is, if when that doesn't happen, what do you get? Do you just pick your own topic? Is that how it works? Then
I'm just right again. That's all.
No, he gets $25.
No, I don't want it. Donate it to the podcast.
I'll donate it to the podcast.
Do you guys? You want to hear a real honest review on the trailer for the
Sophie's Choice?
The new Mortal Kombat movie coming out.
Yes, I want to hear it.
Yes.
Literally me.
Whoa.
At the end of the trailer.
Oh, I like that.
We watched it. We watched it in at the Avalon. And we were like, it was all like Scorpion and like this and like Mortal Kombat. At the very end of it, I sit next to Carly. She goes, And it was just like the.
What movie were you watching?
We went to go see Nobody, but it was just like, it was like that, oh, that's a thing.
Wow. I guess that's right.
Side question. How was Nobody? Because I really want to see
it. Was good. It was good. It was like it's a not great. Comedic
oh, really?
John Wick.
It's not great. It's pretty good.
Okay.
Comedic John Wick.
Does anyone have any final thoughts on the Mortal Kombat movies? Everyone gets.
Are we ranking again? Are we doing
No, we're not ranking them. Everyone, if you have anything to say about Mortal Kombat movies before we bring it home, now's your time.
I don't know, man. I've only thought about this shit for a long time. When we had to research this ourselves, Brad, this became kind of just like, oh, I'm just going to look up a Wikipedia article, and then I would fall asleep. The next day, I would try it again. I would fall asleep. I understood what was going on, and that hurts. Because for a normal human being, I tried to approach this like just a regular person. And then you look at it, and it's like, who's the guy with the crystals on his jacket? What's up with the centaur boy? It's literally...
I wish his name was just
centaur boy. Not a man. He's a boy.
Well, and Jax is like... Jax is like, that's Starfruit from American Gladiators. That's my friend. I'll take him.
All I have to say is...
Did you call him Starfruit?
I didn't know his American Gladiator name. It sounded good to me.
It's very Stardew Valley.
Starfruit.
I don't think your last name get Gladiator.
No, this...
Starfruit and Razor.
For some reason, I always liked the second one better. And then watching it again tonight, I was like, what the fuck was I even thinking? It literally makes me question my taste in general. We'll see. There's going to be a Death Stranding episode of this,
I agree.
We'll get into Dylan Taste later.
Before rewatching this, I would have said Annihilation is so much more entertaining, and the first one didn't age as well, because that's where I was before. But then I was like, now I'm like, the first one is actually better. Holds together really well, and the second one, even though it's so bad, it's not that entertaining most of the time. That's where I'm at this time.
Right.
Ben, you've had a roller coaster today.
This has been great. I loved it.
That's good.
There was like a tense moment where I just needed to sit back and just watch what was unfolding. It was great.
Eat some sun chips.
Yeah, I was like, this is great. But I think my final verdict is it's kind of like, you know, watching a porno. You're not there for the story. That's it.
Wait, you came?
It's for the fighting.
What? You guys didn't? I mean,
well, I hit
Did
it.
Did you see Mataro?
I hit it.
But yeah, that's really it for me. I think it's like it's just there for the entertainment. Like, don't follow the story. You're not going to be able to follow the story all the time.
If we all had to be silent during this movie, I think everyone would have been like, this sucked.
I wanted to hear the
fact that we were making fun of it actually made it a bit more of an experience. Yeah. I think if everyone had... Yeah, I would have too.
Like we talked about earlier, I saw Annihilation in the theaters, and I remember thinking this is one of the worst movies I've ever seen. But I've not seen it since then. I was like, oh, okay, maybe I overreacted because I had hype, you know, whatever. Mm. It's worse than I remember. It was worse. And I do agree, if we were not all just having a good time, jibber-jabbing, talking what we're doing, I would have fallen asleep. It's pretty unwatchable. Yes. It's not fun. It's unwatchable. Like, it's so bad. It's not so bad it's funny. It's so bad it's just like, I'm going to... Close my eyes.
There was one time about like 5 minutes in the film, Ben, you just said, oh, it's a bad movie.
Yeah, I was like,
5 minutes. It was 30 seconds.
It was like straight up. I was just like, guys, this movie's bad.
And then you said it again. You said it again like 50 minutes in. You're like, this is really bad.
It's like, it got to that part, like, especially, like, I think, yeah, in the beginning of the movie, that's when I was like, this is going to be a bad movie because of all that CG that was terrible. And then it got to that part where Jade's just like, I'm the bad one. I'm dead now.
It was like, all too easy.
Too easy. I'm like, you didn't do anything.
Man. Suckers.
Suckers.
Scorpion just, like, at a casino, just, like, not fighting at the end. Like, what's he doing?
When the realms merge, Vegas stays fine. He was just having a good time.
Yeah.
I bet it's all on red.
Yeah, I know the world's back to normal. Keep it going. Come on. Damn.
Carly, bring it home. What are your thoughts?
Terrible. just terrible. I agree. The first one was better because it was good and bad. This one was just bad.
What was your favorite part of either two movies? What made you the happiest?
The nut kicking of what's his name?
Goro.
Goro. And then the potential nut slash
of Wataru?
Yeah.
Thorax.
When Matt didn't know where he got punched.
Yeah,
he punched him in the
very relatable, and because of our
relatable how?
I was like, wait, you get punched in the thorax?
No. Just relatable movie to movie because the punching and what he probably thought was gonna be his manhood.
I mean, I'll
what if Johnny Cage jumped to, like, did a splits and then punched Mataro in the dick? Like, he had to get underneath him.
Yeah.
It wouldn't have been as good.
And then slide it in between his legs and, like, pacha, pacha. Have you seen the size of a horse's dick?
Like a speed bag just going to town.
You gotta do that.
So, if you want to hear our thoughts, our collected thoughts on the new Mortal Kombat movie, you're gonna have to check out Better in 3D. Ben, hopefully you're able to join us over there as well.
Oh,
yeah. You're more than welcome.
We would love to have you. You're great, man.
Thanks. No, thank you guys.
Yeah. So
I want to get you guys on our podcast. Where have you been to?
Oh, I would love.
We're trying to figure out how to bring guests on our show.
Resident Evil. The Resident Evil movies you probably haven't seen.
I've seen them.
They're terrible. They're fun.
Well, we'll find a video game. We'll see a video.
I've seen most of them, I should say.
There's at least one video game movie that you haven't seen.
Yeah, absolutely.
And also, I'm in as far as I'm a musician and I understand music.
Oh, yeah, we talked about it before.
I would love to be on that. Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah.
Ben, how can our fans find you?
Well, hey, don't find me. I like my privacy. But if you want to listen to my podcast, or my two podcasts, it's Not Exactly Radio. You can hit us up on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. We don't do much on there. We're trying to work on that. And then the other one is Where Have You Been? You can hit us up on those same things, those same mediums. And it's spelled differently because Mike, my co-host, he spelled it. It was like, Where Have You Been? And I think the Ben, no, I think it's just the letter B-E-N. U.
It's you.
It's Ben. It's me. But yeah, you can find us anywhere. Thank you for having me. And
I recommend the 10 Things I Hate About You episode. I like
thank
that
you,
one quite
thank
a bit.
You, appreciate that.
And
I've listened to a few.
Matt, if people were trying to find you,
you can find us online. I have a couple podcasts. The one that we just registered was called Better in 3D, which is a proud member of the Davenport Audio Network. If you're more into horror. That was weird. You listen to Horrorgasmo, the Curse Cast, that stars me, local drag queen Sylvia Nix, and Bob talk about unknown horror movies every week. Brad's been on there. You can find us either show on social media. It's Baron3D on Instagram and Horrorgasmo on Instagram for those shows. And I'm personally just not that mad against Snapchat, Instagram, and Twitter. And if you really want to find me, I'll be usually just stalking Brad in the shadows because I'm always looking for my moments. Always looking for a moment where Carly's not around that I can finally just snatch him. Take him and throw him in a bag.
You are less sneaky than you think.
I know. That's why it's never worked. I mean, it's just 2 years on. It's usually like me in the back of the room and Carly's like, man, I can see you. You're not going to kidnap
him. It's you with like a DVD of Mean Girls just open pretending you're reading it. Yeah. At a bar.
One day she's going to sneeze and I'm going to run and just grab you. And I'm like, oh, it's mine now. And I get
jokes on you. I sneeze a lot.
There it is. Okay. Shit.
Wait, Dylan, would the joke be on you then?
I guess so.
Dylan, if they wanted to support Raw Dogs, how could they do that?
The best way to do that is on Patreon. We have a bunch of different tiers with a bunch of different rewards. Currently, we have spaces open in our Discord. We're looking for a bunch of cool people who just want to talk about video games. And you'd be invited no matter what. However, if you want to be our participator, just give us a little bit. But if you don't have any money, I'm just going to say, just recommend us to a bunch of friends if you enjoy what is actually going on here, which debatably some people might not think so. However, I also think that we make a good product here.
It's almost a 10-minute podcast after everything's edited out.
Yeah.
Ben, welcome and goodbye.
I'll recommend their Discord. It's a lot of fun.
It's very fun.
It's a lot of weird jokes. I kind of see the background is hit on Tom every once in a while, but it's fun.
If you want a chill place to hang out and talk to people about video games, this is the place to do it. Also, word of mouth is the best way that we get more traction. And if you don't have any money, you have nothing to give, at least just throw us a recommendation to a friend.
I can do that. Carly, you should listen to the podcast.
Also, I'm Demons Draw Dylan on Instagram. I follow
Demons Draw Dylan. There's a lot of amazing artwork, and he posts some of his thumbnail work he does for the podcast, so check that out.
Yep.
This podcast is brought to you by executive producers from Patreon. Brian Baraka Ward, Tyler Combat Keller, Killer Kip the Katana Killer.
Chiop.
He killed her.
God.
And Rai.
God damn you.
Rai, the really punches Goro the in the nuts guy.
There we go.
Rai, the science
that's
guy.
Really good.
And you can find us on Facebook and Instagram, Hear the Dogcast. We are on Twitter at Hot Dogcast. Go to Better in 3D to hear our thoughts of the next one. And Carly, if they wanted to find you or I for the next week or so, where will we be?
Fucking Disney World.
yeah.
But also, good luck, because I'm barely on social media, so.
Yep.
She's smart.
Thanks for tuning in. Mortal Kombat. What else have we got? Anything?
Mortal Kombat!
As long as the portal remains open, your world becomes my world. Father, the merger has begun. Earth is under attack. And it is glorious!
Pretty cool, huh? It's my animality.